everyone, kind request to take your seat. Session will start now.
Respected delegates, please have a seat. Session is going to start soon. Suprabhatam Vaidyagan. Good morning to all. Please have a seat. Session is going to start. I request everyone. Suprabhatam Vaidyagan. Good morning to all. Welcome all of you to 5th National Conference on Future of Ayurveda 2050, organized by Ayurveda Teachers Association, co-hosted by MOHS Nasik University. Morning's first session was very illuminating by respected speaker Dr. B.S. Prasad sir. I hope our academicians got benefited with the session. Now we are heading towards the next session, which is on topic Future of Ayurveda Research 2050. Research is a creative and systematic work undertaken to increase the stock of knowledge. It involves the collection, organization and analysis of evidence to increase the understanding of topic. Research and development is a very demanding department in a present era. R&D is when business gather knowledge to create new product or discover new ways to improve their existing products and services. In Ayurveda Samhitas, specifically in Vimansana of Charak Sahita, Adhyay 8, there is a very systematic explanation regarding the research under the heading Panchavayu Vakya. Now with this, it's time to invite our dignitaries. I would like to invite Dr. Manohar Gundeti sir on stage, chairperson for this session. Dr. Manohar Gundeti sir, please come on stage. I request Dr. Manohar Gundeti sir, please come on stage.
Welcome Dr. Manohar Gundeti sir. Here I introduce him to all of you. Dr. Manohar Gundeti sir completed his BAMS in 1996 from Shivaji University, Kolhapur. Later on, he pursued his MD Ayurveda in 2005 from Mumbai University and completed PG diploma in epidemiology from IIPH Gurgaon in 2012. Now here I highlight on some profession career development. Sir has started his practice from June 1998, Gundeti Nursing Home, Solapur. Then he started his lectureship from November 2005 at YMT Ayurved Medical College and Hospital, Navi Mumbai. He also worked as a senior research fellow at Indian Institute of History of Medicine, CCRS, Hyderabad in Feb 2008 to October 2009. He had been working as a research officer, Ayurveda, October 2009 to till date. Sir have many achievements. Recipient of Certificate of Excellence, National Institute of Indian Medical Heritage, CCRS, 2010. Recipient of Ayush CCRS Award for Best Research Paper in 2018. Here I highlight some clinical research projects. Sir has completed more than 15 clinical research projects, role as a principal investigator, nodal officer, co-investigators. Some completed projects are clinical evaluation of Ashwagandha Churna and Praval Pisti in the management of osteopenia, osteoporosis, clinical evaluation of Laksha Gugul and Mukta Pusti in the management of osteopenia, osteoporosis as a co-investigator, a cross-sectional study of cancer, KAP, among Ayurveda and Allopathy fraternity as a principal investigator, a randomized placebo control prospective phase second clinical study of an Ayurvedic coded drug Ayush D on glycemic control in pre-diabetic subjects, multicentric study, a study of Ashwagandha in the prophylaxis against COVID-19 and its benefits of general health in high-risk health care workers, a randomized control comparison with hydroxychloroquine sulfate, work as a principal investigator, many cancer-related clinical research projects are also ongoing. Understanding mechanical role of cortisol as in immunomodulatory and anti-cancer formulation against ovarian cancer, work as principal investigator. Then a study of Ashwagandha administration in participant vaccinated against COVID-19 on safety, immunogenicity and protection, a randomized double-blind placebo-controlled multicentric clinical trial. Sir also published lots of publications in national and international journals. Topics mostly on cancer management, cancer care and Ayurvedic formulation in influenza-like illness, efficacy and safety of Ayurvedic medicine, etc. Other publications are Global Climate Change, Implication of Healthcare Service Through Ayurveda at Proceeding of WCMANU 2012, Integrative Oncology, Newer Potential for Immunotherapy and Chemoprevention Poster. Sir also work as Associate Editor, GAMN Journals, Editorial Board Member, GRAS Journal, then also work as a life member in many medical association, NEMA, Andaman Science Association, Andaman and Nicobar, Indian Association for the Study of Traditional Asian Medicine, Pune, and lots of. Okay. Thank you.
Once again, a warm welcome, sir. We are privileged to have respected Dr. Ram Manohar Puthiyedat sir as a speaker for this session. I would like to invite Dr. Ram Manohar sir on stage. Dr. Ram Manohar sir, please come on stage. Dr. Ram Manohar Puthiyedat sir is director of Amrita Center for Advanced Research in Ayurveda, Kerala. Sir did his BMS from Ayurveda College, Coimbatore and PG from ALNRM College, Coimbatore in Dravyagun Vigyan. Sir has a very vast teaching experience. He worked as a lecturer at ALNRM Ayurveda Medical College, COPPA. Sir is an Ayurveda instructor at Southern California University of Health Sciences, USA. He is a visiting lecturer of Ayurveda, Essen University, Germany, faculty of MSc program in Ayurveda, validated by Middlesex University, UK, European Academy of Ayurveda, Boston, Germany. Sir has a very huge experience of research and worked as a principal investigator for various national, international funded research projects for Ayush Ministry under Government of India. Dr. Ram Manohar sir honored with various prestigious awards like Ayurveda Ratna Award, Dhanvantari Award, Dr. Keshav Baliram Hedkewar Award, Bhishak Bhushan Puraskaram, Dr. Sri Dwarkanath Memorial Award, Bharadwaj Puraskaram Award, Vaidya Sundarlal Joshi Smuti Shoth Puraskaram, Ayurved Marga Pravartak Award. Sir has more than 50 national international publications. Also, he is editorial board member on various national international journals. He received scholarship from Society for Integrative Oncology. Sir has visited many countries. United States, United Kingdom, Germany, Denmark, Russia, Singapore, Brazil, Italy, Sri Lanka, and many more to promote Ayurveda. He has been featured in public broadcasting services in USA in documentary titled India, A Second Opinion. He was one of the anchor in documentary The Journey of Ayurveda, produced by Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India. He was interviewed by BBC Radio for London on theme Herbs, Pills and Potions. Now with this, I once again welcome sir and request to deliver lecture on subject.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes,
Dr. Ram Manohar, sir, over to you.
So namaste and pranams to all who have assembled here. It's a great pleasure and honor to be present on this platform to share my views on the future of research in Ayurveda 2050. I'm very thankful to the organizers, especially Vaidehi Madam, for having invited me. So I'm a little bit dizzy because of the late night travel. So kindly excuse me if there is any, you know, low ebb of my energy. So I've been asked to discuss about the future of research in Ayurveda, and I would like to present it within these subheadings. One is the very important question of history of research in Ayurveda. Is research something new that has just emerged, you know, in the post-colonial period, or does Ayurveda also have a history of this activity? And then the whole development of modern era research in Ayurveda, because to look into the future, we need to also look behind. We need to understand, we need to visualize the future in the light of the experiences of our past. So I will try to very briefly, you know, outline the phases of modern era research in Ayurveda, and then look at the current status of research. What is the current status? And I want to give a disclaimer at the outset that I'm taking a critical view, because if the future is to be, you know, really developed in a very robust manner, we need to be self-critical. So I'm not going to, it might look a little pessimistic to the listeners, but I want to say that it is with a purpose. It is to build a future that we are looking critically at what is present. And my statements are, you know, quite sweeping in the sense we are looking at the major issues and problems that plague Ayurveda research. I'm not going into the details. And then we will quickly outline the future directions for Ayurveda research. What is the major steps that we need to take so that Ayurveda research will matter and it will make a global impact, you know, in the field of healthcare. We know today that Ayurveda is getting recognized globally, but one of the major impediments for its legal recognition is the lack of evidence and you know a research base. Even though Ayurveda is a codified knowledge system, the knowledge in Ayurveda is not you know randomly generated, but there is a challenge in presenting this information in a form that is acceptable to modern scientific community and regulatory authorities. So we are looking at research in two angles. One is, who is this research for? It is not necessarily for the Ayurveda physicians or Ayurveda community, because we have our own method of validating. It's not that it's only after doing this kind of research that an average Ayurveda practitioner is going to get convinced in Ayurveda. No. Through our clinical practice, we are constantly witnessing the benefits and strengths of Ayurveda. But in order for Ayurveda to get accepted legally and gain currency within the scientific community, we need to present Ayurveda in a particular way. So two purposes are there. One is for validating, creating knowledge in the field of Ayurveda. The other is for acceptance. So there is also a political angle to research. Like, research should also look at the current politics of how traditional systems are regulated worldwide. So with these introductory remarks, we'll first look at the history of research in Ayurveda. So we know that we have coined new terms like Anusandhan, Shodhan, Pariksha, Gaveshana. All these are terms that you don't find in the classical texts by themselves to denote research. In fact, if you look at traditional knowledge systems, not only Ayurveda but other systems also, you may not find a separate discipline called research. This is because, in my opinion, research was ingrained in the education, research was ingrained in the practice process, because we had the pramanas. You know, knowledge could be accepted only if it is validated. So that was part of the educational process also, that was part of the practice also. So for example, I just want to remind you, Charaka Samhita says that this text itself is a result of an attempt to distinguish between what is Sat and Asat. We are not dealing with Asat or imaginary things. We are dealing only with what is Sat. Sarvam khalu dvidhameva khalu sarvam satcha asatcha tasya chaturvidha pariksha. So Ayurveda is based, Ayurvedic knowledge itself is based on the concept of pariksha. Pariksha is a good word for research, because it means verification, examination, investigation. So this you can see is at the heart of the Ayurvedic knowledge system. And Charaka Samhita again points out that treatment outcome not supported by rationale is accidental or chance effect. So it is not that the Ayurvedic tradition was accepting everything. Clinicians are treating patients, they are getting better, and then we say, oh, Ayurveda is great. That was not the system. Charaka clearly says, if I treat a patient, patient gets better. But if I don't know how to explain how and why it happened, vina tarkena ya siddhi, yadrucha siddhi revasa. So Ayurveda is one of the earliest medical systems to distinguish between real effect and chance effect of treatments. Natra vaidyaha roga pramokshe karanam. This is what Chakrapani is giving comments. Natra vaidyaha roga pramokshe karanam. Even though the patient has got better, the physician is not responsible for that. It has happened accidentally. Which means that every treatment that we do, we have a responsibility to document it and explain how and why it happened. So this was a clinical practice outcome that Charaka. And there is a very interestingly, many I noticed this term, you know, quite some time back. Chakrapani's commentary alone has a term called Pratinyamiki Siddhi. So in statistics we use P is equal to, and that is exactly the concept of Pratinyamiki Siddhi, the probability that the outcome was not due to chance but due to the real effect of the treatment. So we have a term Pratinyamiki Siddhi and Yadrucha Siddhi. So this is considering the time period in which these points have been discussed, it's amazing. These ideas came into modern medicine very, very recently. Now if you look at Anumana, there are two procedures in Anumana. One is establishing correlation. We have all studied it, but we have not looked at it perhaps in the context of research. All observational studies are based on the Ayurvedic concept of Anumana, Purvavat, Sheshavat, Samanyato Drishta. That is, you know, prospective, retrospective, and cross-sectional designs. Pratyaksha purvam trividham trikalam chanumiyate vanyar nigudho dhumena maithunam garbhadarshanat. So we we also tried to establish cause and effect relationships through a careful process of Anumana. These are all, so if you ask how Ayurvedic knowledge was built, I have just tried to give a brief summary. There are much, much more details. There is no time to go into all that. In fact, we can build, that's a project I'm working on, how we can build an outline of an Ayurveda-inspired research methodology based on these concepts and incorporating, you know, relevant concepts from modern science, modern research. So this is establishing correlation. We knew that correlation is not causation. Just because A and B are seen together, it is only vyapti. I mean, sahacharya. From sahacharya, you have vyapti. From vyapti, you have to go further. The second stage of Anumana, and this is historically speaking very significant, that they had two different steps for establishing correlation and causation. In order to accept causation, you needed to compare with a positive and negative control. Sapaksha, vipaksha and paksha. So if you don't have a control, then you cannot accept causation. Just by, so you can see that, similarly if you look at the study of drugs, aushadham hyanabhi jnadam, nabarupa gunais tribhi, vijnadam chapi duryuktam anarthayopapadyade. Which means that no medicine should be used if it is, if you do not know it well. It's not whether it is mentioned in the text. If you have no thorough knowledge, nama, rupa, guna, yukti, jnana of a medicine, a very detailed what you can call as material safety data sheet and all those things that we are talking about today, they had insisted that we need to know. Now what I want to also add is that Ayurvedic knowledge, which I have not put in a slide, but I just want to make mention of it, that Ayurvedic knowledge has developed through processes, three processes. One is Atindriya Jnanam, which we can call today as serendipity, intuition and whatever it is. Then Drishyam, direct perception, observation, you know, the way modern research is done. And then Tarkyam. Tarkyam means debatable. This is very important to understand. All Ayurvedic knowledge we need not blindly believe. Charaka clearly says there are certain aspects of our Samhita which is Tarkyam. Ataparam Tarkyam eva. It is not established. So you don't need to now swear on the components of the Samhita that are Tarkya. If we want to create a new Samhita, this is something which we must keep in mind. The Tarkya portions should be re-examined. What is not relevant should be removed. The Drishya portions can be verified through proper modern research. Whereas Atindriya part, we need to do meditation, you know, contemplation. So even in modern medicine, serendipity, like the way Alexander Fleming discovered, penicillin, and way animals, zoo pharmacognosy, animals, there is a story of an animal, the sparrow was picking up cigarette butts from a New Mexico University campus. The researchers got surprised. Sparrows also want to smoke or what? Because they are going and picking up all these cigarette butts. Then they found that the sparrows were using the tobacco to line their nests to prevent parasites from coming and attacking the eggs. Now how did the sparrows know? By just one look at that cigarette butt, that it has a chemical that can prevent the parasites from attacking their eggs. It would take centuries of human effort to even make a correlation. That is why the Atharva Veda says a lot of properties about medicinal plants we have learned is through animals. Varaho Veda Bheshajam, Nagulo Veda Bheshajam. So I'm just giving a brief summary that we can say that Ayurveda was also a research-based system, but we need to cull out this information and present it in a way that modern community can understand that Ayurvedic knowledge did not happen haphazardly. And also that we don't have to accept everything. There are portions, the Tarkya portion of the text, which we really need to update for Ayurveda to get acceptance. So with this, I want to go to the modern era research in Ayurveda, where we will review the development of Ayurveda research in modern era. And I want to divide it into various phases, how modern research in Ayurveda developed. It was in the pre-colonial period. It all began when the colonizers came and they started reporting, you know, what is happening in India. We did not document that phase. Like for example, if these Britishers and other Westerners who came to India had not documented this information, we would have never known that smallpox inoculation existed in India. That a potter community, I think it was in Pune, who were still doing the nasal reconstruction surgery. So the earliest modern type of documentation happened in the pre-colonial era, and it was Garcia da Horta, you know, a Portuguese scholar. And this is what I want to also highlight. While Ayurveda had its own tradition of validation of research, which we saw a glimpse about, where all these methodologies are there, modern research in Ayurveda has been led by people outside the field of Ayurveda. This is a very big statement I want to make. There has been lack of research leadership in the field of Ayurveda. If any research has made an impact, it has been done by people outside India. Now, if you look at the high impact publishers in the field, you'll find names like Bhushan Patwardhan, Professor M.S. Valiathan's team, or Ashok Vaidya. All the big names have come from outside. And this tradition has started with the Britishers. So, Pharmacopoeia was compiled by Garcia da Horta, that opened the whole traditional knowledge system to the West. So, what I want to say is that modern research in Ayurveda is an attempt, it's only reflecting the Western world's attempt to understand Ayurveda. It is not an attempt by the Ayurvedic community to update Ayurveda, but it is an attempt by the Western world to understand and utilize Ayurveda for development of modern science. We have not been involved in this process. Hendrik van Reed also had this Hortus Malabaricus. Then you can see the colonial and early post-colonial period, Ayurveda was reduced to history. Historians, philologists, Sanskritists, these are the people who started studying Ayurveda. And they influenced Indian thinking also a lot. Many, many Indian scholars are influenced by people like Dominic Gujasti, Kenneth Zisk, who tells us that Ayurveda has no connection with Vedas, but has originated from Buddhism. And all these new ideas have come up. People started looking at Ayurveda purely historically. Then you have the early post-independence period, when again we are looking at Ayurveda's current relevance, bioprospecting, that Ayurveda could give leads. The discovery of reserpine from Rauvolfia Serpentina triggered this process. And since then, ethnobotanical studies have been happening. And one such incidence is PBGRI and Ayurveda Pharmacy, you know, developed a product from Jeevani, which became also controversial. But it is a good model if it is pursued properly, where the traditional knowledge can be commercialized with scientific support, and the original community can also be benefited. So this was the bioprospecting era. And then we have the modern research in Ayurveda. Now this has become very, very core now, that, and this is the way we are thinking of research in Ayurveda also, that all that is there in Ayurveda should be evaluated using modern scientific parameters. That is why we are now teaching our students also modern scientific methods. In UG also it has started, PG also, and then, you know, PhD, all these things. But we have to understand that the limitation of this approach is that we are trying to study Ayurveda through the lens of modern science. What is acceptable to modern science will get accepted, the remaining will get rejected. So here we have all these modern research. It's a whole big story I've tried to summarize into one slide. The birth of CCRAS, Nimitli, TKDL, all these things are part of this initiative of scientific validation. So we can see there is a gradual evolution, and there are phase transitions. In the first, the discovery, just documenting. Then looking at Ayurveda historically, then looking at it as potential source of new drugs, then trying to validate and integrate it with modern science. But the bottom line is that all this research, the leadership is from outside the field of Ayurveda. It is people outside the field of Ayurveda is telling us how we should do research in Ayurveda. So when we look into the future, one major lacuna is lack of research leadership. Can Ayurveda physicians, Ayurvedic community itself tell the world this is how research should be done in Ayurveda? That is a question. Then we have postmodern research initiatives, where there's some kind of bridging between Ayurvedic concepts. Like we have the famous reverse pharmacology approach. People began to realize that the exact methods of modern science cannot be applied in Ayurveda. So we need to modify. So reverse pharmacology, scientific validation of the basic concepts of Ayurveda, Ayurveda biology, whole medical systems approach for clinical research, the beginning to understand that modern methods will not apply as it is to study Ayurveda. We need to change it. So this is how modern, this is where we stand now. This is how the whole research scenario has changed in the modern period. So now I want to talk about the current status, and I have to, as I said, I am looking at it very critically. Critically because I have a deep desire that we don't keep our standards low. We need to really reach out globally. And so one of the major concerns about Ayurvedic research today is the poor quality of research. This is the reason why. So I want to tell you that a lot of Ayurveda research gets into shady journals, and a very strong effort has to be taken to prevent even good research getting lost in predatory journals or, you know. So there are exceptions. I don't want, the problem is there are good research also. I don't want to highlight that to give us a false sense of complacency. The good research is not creating a critical mass to create an impact. If you look at it globally, I have had the chance to travel widely, go to various universities. The problem is they say your good research is just like, you know, a flash in the pan. Once here and there you see some good studies, but majority are not good enough. So, for example, lack of conversion of preclinical to clinical studies, lack of mechanism of action studies to back clinical studies. These are all some of the major gaps. Now, if you look at poor quality of publications, PubMed has 9,000 citations for Ayurveda. Just if you look at it now, whereas Chinese medicine already has 348,000. So that's a huge difference, 9,000 versus 348,000. So after all these years, decades, we have been able to churn out only 9,000. According to the editor of New England Journal of Medicine, even in modern medicine, 50% of published literature is junk. And in Ayurveda, we can say 70% is junk. Which means if you reduce from 9,000, 70%, then we have only a handful of research papers. With this, we cannot create a global impact. So we need to really think about how to improve quality and quantity of research. Another big challenge, like this is a vicious circle. We don't have funding opportunities. So we can have big ideas, but implementing is very difficult. I can tell in my own experience, we started a study in Coimbatore about whole system Ayurvedic research in rheumatoid arthritis, started in 1978. That study, to convert that into a bigger study, it took 25 years. The second study made a big impact. Third study is now going on with CCRAS. Dr. Manohar Gundeti is also part of that process. It took another 10 years to reach. So the funding and, you know, facilities available to do high impact research, it's very, very challenging. So if you look at modern, people usually ask why there is no research in Ayurveda. Modern research has a funding ecosystem. They are spending trillions and trillions of dollars. Just now I read a paper saying that billions of dollars were wasted on post-COVID research. They have money to waste also, but in Ayurveda we don't. We don't have. So it is very difficult to do research. Funding has to be upscaled. Good research, but funding, by just increasing funding, the problem won't be solved. We have to have funding for good research. So we need to really develop good research methodologies and then plan. It has to be a strategic plan. And the major problem is modern research methods are blindly adopted in Ayurveda. Single drug, single disease approach. Ayurveda is studied in a way, it is not the way in which it is practiced. If I'm sitting in a clinic, I will give a complete treatment. But if I do a PG thesis, I will take one medicine and study it. I'm reminded of a story. I will tell another thing, one medicine for all approach. Lack of collaboration, lack of multidisciplinary, transdisciplinary approach. And Professor M.S. Valiathan's, we need to connect with other disciplines also and put them also on board. So multidisciplinary, transdisciplinary research should be promoted. We cannot just sit and do our own work and expect, because that's why I told there are two issues here, Swarthanuman and Pararthanuman. Today research is mainly for Pararthanumana. We are trying to convince the regulatory and scientific bodies. So having them on board also is very helpful. In my own experience, we were able to publish papers. And I have a couple of publications in the world's highest impact journals. A few publications that was possible only by bringing, you know, the modern one is in oncology. A cancer journal for clinicians has a whopping. At that time when we published it, it had an impact factor of 508. Even today, it is the highest impact factor journal. No Ayurveda clinician or researcher can reach such journals if they do, you know, isolated work. If you bring these people also on board, we can quickly reach. I also got a chance to publish in Annals of Rheumatic Diseases because Dr. Daniel First, a rheumatologist, was part of our study. So if we begin bring that strategy, then very quickly we can have, you know, high impact publications. So with this brief overview, I want to suggest what are the future directions for research in Ayurveda. So what we need is a paradigm shift. We cannot still be thinking in the same way. We have to make a big paradigm shift. We need to discover research methods suited for Ayurveda. So NIH funded study is an example. We did a randomized controlled trial where the design was modified to suit Ayurveda. We don't have time to talk about this, but this study won the Excellence in Integrative Medicine Research Award from European Society of Integrative Medicine at a time when Europe was trying to push Ayurveda out of Europe. So it made a big impact. So it means that if we are able to have a strategic approach and use the right methods, then we will definitely be able to make an impact. So focus on practice-based evidence. Focus should be on real-world practice. What happens at point of care? At Amrita, we have now set up an AyurCell portal where clinicians can come and, you know, deposit their clinical experience. Our team will help them to convert it into case narratives, free of cost. But still, to get 100 case reports, we have struggled. Our community is not willing to come and openly share. So our goal is to make it into 100, 500, 1000, maybe 10,000. If we have such a case repository which is very carefully curated, then you know it will make a lot of interest and impact. Even just looking at the diagnosis which Ayurvedic clinicians are treating, we have not been able to tell the world what is happening, like the clinical practice, like an underworld of Ayurveda. Nobody knows what is going on there. If we start really good clinicians start coming out, we can make a big difference. So Ayurveda should be studied. So first we need to find out what works and then understand, you know, how and why it works. So this is a story that comes to my Birbal and Akbar. Very quickly I will tell that is representing the current status of Ayurveda. Birbal once wanted Akbar to get the four great fools of his country. And then Birbal said, two already found. Birbal and Akbar, because you know, Akbar always has these strange ideas and Birbal will always follow him. So here are the two fools, other two I will find out. And as he was walking out, I think he found a person, you know, that story is not relevant to us. He found another fool. The last fool, as he was working around, he saw somebody under a lamppost was frantically searching for something. So Birbal asked him, what are you searching? He was not even willing to, you know, reply. But when finally Birbal insisted, can't you see I'm looking for my ring? It's a very precious diamond ring and I want to get it. Then Birbal looked around, he couldn't see anything. And then he asked, are you sure you lost it here? Then he said, of course not. I lost it there. It is so dark there that I'm looking under the lamppost. Now this is the way research is happening in Ayurveda. Because we are using modern methods of research because it is easy to do. But where is the knowledge of Ayurveda is lost in the complexity. It is lost where we are actually giving clinical practice. Why we are not studying it? Because multifactorial. Oh, there is diet, there is lifestyle. So it is the darkness we see in our clinical practice. So we don't want to study it the way it is practiced. So what we need to do is to not look under the lamppost, but bring the lamppost to where there is darkness and then search and discover. This means we have to modify our research methodologies. So another thing is mixed methods. When you talk about research methodology, we need to address, you know, combination of qualitative, quantitative methods are necessary. And there are so many examples, again, there is no time. All of these points require elaborate discussions. You know, what do you mean by mixed methods? How we can combine qualitative, quantitative methods to suit the complexity of Ayurveda? Non-linearity. We have to move away from averages to study of... See, Ayurveda is talking about non-linear phenomenon. It's not that when you give an input, the output is not a straight line, it's a curve. The Ayurvedic concept of Tridosha itself is discussing about non-linear dynamics. And we are using methods which are dealing with linear phenomenon to study Ayurveda, which is discussing non-linear phenomenon. Another thing is variability. See, for us, one average value has no meaning. We are looking at the pattern of doshas across time. For us, one value of blood pressure is not as meaningful as the whole pattern of how blood pressure fluctuates. Because what we need to know is, how is the blood pressure, body is stabilizing blood pressure according to circumstance. So today wearables may be necessary to be able to get variability, studying variability. This is important in Ayurveda. And Ayurvedic idea is not homeostasis, it is homeodynamics. This is a new term that we can introduce. Tridoshas represent the concept of homeodynamics. It's not a static. So these things will completely change the way research is done. And all this means, who will take the leadership? Ayurvedic community has to take. We cannot wait for MS Valiathan. They're all doing great work, but as long as we don't take the initiative, we won't find the right method for doing research in Ayurveda. So finally, integrative approaches. Today, when we do research, we have to show not how Ayurveda lives by itself in an imaginary world. Ayurveda is not alone. Ayurveda is coexisting with other medical systems. So all our research should show how it can be integrated into the healthcare system. Otherwise, it's not going to get accepted. And we have to move from a system-centric approach to a patient-centric approach. Finally, when we present our results, we have to tell how is a patient going to be benefited, not how Ayurveda is going to be glorified. Because when the patient is benefited, Ayurveda gets glorified. So I'm coming to the concluding remarks. I hope I'm on time. So there are so many approaches to research in Ayurveda. I'm just summarizing again. It's a very sweeping statements. Requires, each one of them requires a lot of discussion. If you look at the trends in research and what we should take, these are the trends that I have identified in my own career as a researcher. One approach is extracting Ayurveda knowledge using modern tools of research. So you will take ashwagandha, take some withanolides or something, and then say this is immunomodulator. After that, ashwagandha is gone. Then it is completely absorbed into the modern system. Like artemisinin from Artemisia annua, it becomes an anti-malarial drug. And then the whole context and background is lost. Second is validating and applying Ayurveda knowledge on the basis of modern scientific. Here we are not extracting, but we want scientific proof. Only if scientific proof is there, we will accept it. So like for example, Chara Sutra was validated in this way, and some treatments can be validated, but more complex treatments cannot be validated using this method. Then the third approach is where we are enriching Ayurveda with modern tools. We are not validating it, but we are taking things from modern, adding to Ayurveda and making it more enriched. Like we have used stethoscope, we are using, you know, modern methods of diagnosis, all those things. And then integrating and Ayurveda, all this is eventually going to lead to integration of Ayurveda and modern medical scientific knowledge. Where using, but the whole focus in all these methods is using modern scientific tools as the measuring rod. Now my question and the last point which I would like all of you to think about is that don't we need also a research methodology for self-validation and discovery of new knowledge and applications from Ayurveda? If the current trends continue, Ayurveda will get reduced to what modern medicine can take out of it. But should not Ayurveda continue as its own system? We can have these collaborations. So in my opinion, all these approaches should coexist. It is not one against the other. All these approaches in research that is happening will contribute to the future of Ayurveda. But as Ayurveda community, our focus should be on the last point. Because other things are to be done by West. See, what they can do, we must leave them to do. What we can do, we must do ourselves. And so my appeal for the future of research in Ayurveda is a strong call for research leadership within the Ayurvedic community and a strong emphasis on the last approach that should be taken. So with this, I conclude. Namaste. I hope this was meaningful in some way. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your precise, elaborative and very informative lecture on topic Future of Ayurveda Research. Now, I would like to request Dr. Manohar Gundeti, sir, to share his view. If anyone have any doubts, questions, they can ask.
Hello. Just I wanted to know two particular points, sir. One, you are asking the Ayurvedic teachers to do the collaborative research. And twice you have referred Professor Valiathan's reference. But I wanted to know how many Ayurvedic teachers are already having the knowledge of M.S. Valiathan's paper.
Sir, I am not in a position to answer that question. If you ask me whether we should make this research more widely disseminated, then I would say yes. One thing is I am not part of the teaching, you know, faculty or the community of Ayurveda. I am an independent researcher. And I also agree that this research has not got enough visibility and discussion. You know, these all the papers that M.S. Valiathan published, I won't say they are ideal, but they are a very important step forward to stimulate and understand the possibility of researchers and scientists coming together. Ayurveda people having showing their expertise, modern doctors and modern scientists giving their expertise, because then it has more value. If we try to do modern, that is the only reason I mentioned. I know I am not answering your question. We may have to do a survey to find out how much, you know, teachers are aware of this research. Only if you do a survey, we will know that. But the strength of that model is that today when I am doing a research in my college, I have to use the modern skills which I have not learned completely. If I work in a lab, you know, I have to learn all those things. I can never become an expert in that field. If it is a modern scientist who is doing that part and I am doing only the Ayurvedic part, then we have the best experts from both fields have come together. The whole research becomes more credible. That is what I had actually intended.
And second point, which I have already asked, again I am just repeating. Okay. Now, in most of the Ayurveda, especially in Dravya Guna, we talk about the alternative medicines, alternative original source. So, what is its effect? Especially when you are talking about the modern scientific tools and when you are talking about the plant identification.
Yes, I hope you are mentioning about substitutes. Is it substitutes you are intending?
I am not talking about the substitutes, especially the wrong identification and wrong
adulterants.
And the wrong adulterants which has been used in most of the Ayurvedic formulations.
Yes, I think there are many issues to this. One is, of course, there are many regulations in place. In our country, the problem is regulations are made, but they are not enforced. So we will need more enforcement to make sure that these practices are curtailed. But on the other hand, I also feel that, you know, Ayurvedic herbs, we cannot completely study them using modern pharmacological or pharmaceutical methods. Today, this is the modern reductionistic approach, is break everything to its parts, understand the parts, and so we know the whole. Like if you look at the human body, we say it is made up of atoms, cells, we break it down, systems, organs, tissues, cells, atoms. We study each of these components and we say we understood the whole. But it's not like that, because in a single herb has maybe 30,000 chemicals. It's not possible for any of the existing technology today to study all these. In Ayurveda, we want all the 30,000 together. We are not wanting to give up even one single chemical. We use the plant as a whole and then we modify process. So newer and modern methods of research like network pharmacology is a more complex way of studying pharmacology than the traditional pharmacology. So those methods may have to be included. And if you really look at the regional substitutes and alternatives used, it's a big challenge. I think because it is the industry that is making us to compromise this. Because if we really look at the truth, no industrial production would be possible. So that is unfortunately the situation. So I think we have to still continuously work, create awareness, bring in more standards, and eventually we can, you know, overcome these problems.
Thank you, sir. You have given very elaborate description and the areas which future Ayurveda research should go ahead. And just I wanted to know a few things. Like we always do on modern parameter, as you mentioned, as we know, it's only because it is easy to do.
Yes.
Like we don't have our own parameters. So whether anybody has developed till date any parameters for a particular type of research, one thing, if not, then we don't have any option. Like when we run an institution and when a student has to do mandatory research and we don't have our own tool, and then like
we repeat the same process.
Yeah, we are going ahead in the research leadership and funding. These two are our primary challenges. Because of that, we are again in that vicious circle. Yes. So, can you just say any?
Yes, I see. Again, it is very painful that these new research methods are being proposed by Westerners. Because now, when I was doing this NIH study, I came to know NIH classified Ayurveda, National Institute of Health, US, they classified Ayurveda as whole medical system, indicating that Ayurveda cannot be studied like individual practices. It's a complex system. So they are talking about complexity science, a new method, whole medical system research. They even coined a term. And there are, you know, researchers like Jennifer Ryokes, then Bertrand Grass. They have published a lot of papers on how we can develop tools. Ayurveda community has tried to develop a lot of tools, but they have not been properly validated. So they are not gaining, you know, international currency. So I think there are methodologies, research methodologies. It may be good in the beginning to get some help from these, because they are pro-Ayurveda also. They are pro-traditional medicine. There is a group of thinkers in the Western world itself who have understood that current methods don't suit Ayurveda. They have taken the leadership, but now it's okay. We can, because they have made some ground, we don't have to reinvent the wheel. We can start initiating discussions with them and bring them in and help them to help us figure out how we can develop our own validated tools. Because a lot of qualitative methods are needed. How to assess ama, how to assess the various avasthas, you know, how to diagnose a disease, a clinical diagnostic criteria. For all our, these things are possible to develop, but we will need the help of some methodologists.
Okay.
I think, as you rightly said, unless, you know, we bring changes at policy level, facilitate research methodologies, I don't think the change can happen, because a college or institution is just in the flow. A student comes, they have to finish their PG thesis, they cannot keep worrying about research methodology, the course will be over. So you have rightly pointed out that difficulty. So I think we need a more strategic policy level change, and for that a think tank has to be created and a much more serious deliberation has to happen. Regarding, and I think bodies like CCRIS and also independent institutions who are not under this pressure of, you know, academic work, they should actually work in this field.
Any other questions?
So, thank you, Dr. Ramanur, sir, for your insightful lecture on this particular topic, what will be the state of research in 2050. So, he nicely reviewed the current status, he talked about the history, and also he proposed the future research roadmap in 2050. So when I heard about his lecture, few of the things which I really found very interesting, like he talked about the new world, like prati niyama siddhi, that is, he talked about p-value. So whenever we heard Ram sir, we get something new every time. In a lecture we get a new pearl of wisdom. And he talked about Ayurveda inspired research methodology, which is a need of our. In fact, in every slide he was mentioning about we should work on, and even one of the experts from the audience asked about the question, what are the methodologies and should be developed. So there is a need. There is no doubt that there is a need of developing tools which are based on Ayurvedic fundamentals. He talked about paradigm shift and also talked about the real world studies. Yes, now the world is looking after, the research world is going beyond the RCTs, that is real-time research or real-time real-world studies which are happening in Western countries. And more importantly, AI, that is artificial intelligence, is taking a good initiative or good contribution in conducting various research studies in this field. He talked about the complexity of Ayurveda. And importantly, he also spoke about the homeodynamics. This is a very important term. I think we should be working in coming days on homeodynamics. He talked about the patient-centric research and patient-centric service. And lastly, he mentioned about the research for self-validation and discovery of new knowledge and application for Ayurveda. When I look about research in Ayurveda retrospectively 25 years back, when we started our career after BMS. So it started with somewhere in CCRS, started somewhere with surveys, doing medicinal plant surveys, collecting folklore claims, documentation, and so many things happened. Later that converted into the validation of the classical formulations, developing some clinical evidence. So that was such type of studies have been conducted. And currently we are working on mechanistic aspects of various formulations, drugs, concept, fundamentals, collaborating with various national institutes, IITs, ICERs, NITs, and even IISc Bangalore also. So in the coming days, we'll be looking ahead towards innovation, what Ram sir was talking in a live slide about the innovation that will be. Now we are working in the era of genomics, microbiomics, transcriptomes, so many, a new era of research is happening, and we need to collaborate with these scientists, this research world, and we should be working on decoding our fundamentals of Ayurveda based on this upcoming concept which are emerging in the science. So lastly, I would like to say that who is going to this? Yes, these are the young shoulders. They will be taking this research in 2050. So there are challenges. Our institute should be growing, upgrading and upscaling like IITs, ICERs, where high quality research will be taken in coming years. So that will be definitely, I hope that we should opt for Mission Nobel Prize in coming years, maybe 2050, we should opt for that. And I am damn sure that this new upcoming generation will work on the research in Ayurveda for this cause. So thank you once again, Dr. Ram sir, for your this thought-provoking lecture and guiding the audience in this session. Thank you, and shall I conclude? Oh, you would like to. So thank you once again, organizers, for giving me this opportunity to chair the session of Ram sir. Thank you very much, and for your patient listening.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your valuable advice. Now, I would like to request Dr. Manoj Chaudhary, sir, to felicitate our Today's speaker, Dr. Ram Manohar Pujhiyadath sir, with certificate and memento as a token of love. Thank you, sir. I request Dr. Anand Madgundi sir to felicitate our chairperson Dr. Manohar Gundeti sir with certificate and memento. Thank you, sir. It's time for vote of thanks. Thank you so much, Dr. Ram Manohar sir, for enlightening us with your speech. Thank you, sir, for sharing your time with us on our platform. Thank you, Dr. Gundeti sir, for sharing your valuable words and giving us your precious time for the conference. I pay my sincere gratitude to ATA for organizing such a wonderful conference and giving me chance to share the stage. I am also thankful to the coordinator, Dr. Pallavi Pardeshi Madam, for her help and guidance to execute this session smoothly. Thank you. Thank you so much, our audience, energetic delegates, for your energetic and active participation. Thank you so much. Next session is on research-driven Ayurvedic medicines under the future of Ayurveda research. Good morning, all of you. Once again, welcome to this conference. This session is about research-driven Ayurveda medicines under future of Ayurveda research. Every single drug, every single herb possesses its own property, and if it is combined with some other drug, may bring the miracle formulation. To elaborate this topic, we have Dr. Sushant Patil sir, marketing manager, Shri Dhrut Papeshwar Limited, as a speaker, and Dr. Neeta Mesekar madam, director, NEIAH Shillong, Meghalaya, as a chairperson, and Dr. Vinod Chaudhary sir, as a chairperson. I would like to request Dr. Mesekar ma'am to come on stage. Dr. Neeta Mesekar ma'am, Director, Northeastern Institute of Ayurveda and Homeopathy, Shillong, Meghalaya. She did her UG and PG from Dr. B.R.K.R. Ayurved College, Hyderabad, and PhD from CSMSS, Kanchanwadi, Aurangabad. She has very huge teaching experience of 31 years, supervised 8 PhD scholars. She was honored with Lifetime Achievement Award at Dehradun in 2020, and ma'am is a gold medalist, honored with Achanta Lakshmipati Gold Medal at Dr. B.R.K.R. Ayurved College, Hyderabad during her UG. Ma'am contributed for e-book on female infertility. Ma'am published book on Ayurvedic solutions to univapath female disorders. Served as a member of board of studies at MUHS Nashik, Maharashtra. Examiner for UG and PG at MUHS Nashik, Baba Saheb Ambedkar Marathwada University, Shivaji University, Gujarat Ayurved University, Jamnagar, RGHU, Bangalore. She is a member of Staff Selection Committee, MUHS Nashik. She is a BOS, Board of Studies at MUHS Nashik. She is paper setter for MPSC for UG and PG examination of MUHS University, RGHU University, at Baba Saheb Ambedkar Marathwada University, Shivaji University, Gujarat Ayurved University, Kolkata University, West Bengal, Madam has invited as a guest speaker, resource person, experts, panelists in various national and international conferences and workshops. She has 7 international and 3 national article publications. Madam is a member of NCSM New Delhi, member of Ayush Committee for Ayurvedic Syllabus Revival at Bangalore, member of advisory board member at International Journal of Ayurvedic Medicine. Dr. Vinod Chaudhary, sir, I would like to request Dr. Vinod Chaudhary, sir, to please come on stage. Actually, sir, is already on the stage. Dr. Vinod Chaudhary, sir, is a professor and HOD at Rachna Shariri Department in Shri Ayurved College, Nagpur, PG and PhD guide since last 15 years. He is PG and PhD in charge also, Senate member at MHS Nashik and professor since last 15 years. Sir has a teaching experience of 23 years. Sir honored with the prestigious awards like Best Rachna Shariri Teacher Award, Best PhD Thesis Award. Sir has more than 20 national and international publications. Sir has invited as a guest speaker, resource person, and experts in various national and international seminars. Now I would like to request Dr. Sushant Patil, sir, on stage. Dr. Sushant Patil, sir, as a speaker.
Welcome. Today's our eminent speaker, Dr. Sushant Patil, sir. Sir, working in Shri Dhut Papeshwar Limited since 8 years, he currently looking after all India and Nepal marketing of Vikrant and Vismay division as a marketing manager. Earlier work with Madhobagh Cardiac Clinic on the position of Deputy Operational Head for Western Mumbai, handling 28 clinics. Has delivered many lectures on cardiac health to general public and conducted camps for early diagnostic of cardiac disorder. Sir have delivered lectures on Our Children's Our Tomorrow as a launch of Shri Dhut Papeshwar Limited, Swarna Prashan at Lucknow, Mumbai and Bangalore. Also delivered lecture at various national events organized by organization like Nanal Foundation, Ayurved Vyaspit, Vishwa Pandhari, Vishwa Ayurved Parishad. Sir, having a practice in Mumbai from past 11 years with special proficiency in bone and joint disorders. He has completed his MBA in marketing from the prestigious Indian Institute of Management, Kolkata, and MD in Sanhita Siddhan. He has played a pivotal role in launch of new products of Dhut Papeshwar, including Mahaswarna Yog and unique form of Swarna Prashan. Sir has conducted more than 50 CME at various colleges across India and Nepal on the manufacturing of Swarna Bhasma, have been moderating webinar conducted by SDL and have moderated 18 such webinar till date. Now I would like to request sir and continue her lecture on topic research driven Ayurvedic medicine. Thank you.
Thank you. Namaste Sharade Devi Veena Pustaka Dharini Vidyarambha Karishyami Prasanna Bhava Sarvada. Paying obeisance to Lord Dhanvantari, dignitaries present on the dais, of the dais, my teachers and my fellow colleagues. Shri Dudh Papeshwar Limited may not be a new name over here. Anybody sitting over here who have heard the name Dudh Papeshwar for the first time can raise their hands. Okay, I have one person who has listened to the word Dudh Papeshwar for the first time. So, let me just introduce to Shri Dudh Papeshwar Limited. It's a 151-year-old enterprise manufacturing authentic, standardized, safe and efficacious Ayurveda medicines. And one more feather to add in the cap can be science-driven legacy. At Shri Dudh Papeshwar Limited, we are committed to give you authentic Ayurveda medicines. And after lecture of, I suppose, Dr. Ram Manohar sir, it has become easier for me to communicate what research and how we are conducting the research at Shri Dudh Papeshwar Limited. Not taking much of your time, this is a short presentation where we'll be giving an idea what Dudh Papeshwar does for evidence-based Ayurveda studies. Till date, we have more than 34 papers of national and international peer-reviewed journals that we have published. And we are proud to say that not only on the basis of Ayurveda parameters, but also on modern parameters, these researches have been standardized. As we know that in Ayurveda, swasthasya swastha rakshanam aturasya vikara prashamanam cha. And on that basis, we have tried to idealize that research is not only based for the products which are for the older people or the geriatric use, but also for the younger generations where we develop Swarna Prashan. So Ayurveda is not only about preventive aspect, but also with regards to the curative and the rejuvenative aspect. Earlier, when Vaidyas used to manufacture their own medicine, the authenticity of the medicine was guaranteed. There are still very good eminent Vaidyas who believe that medicine manufacturing should be done from their end. But every time it is not possible for a Vaidya to manufacture medicine because we never know what kind of a patient comes to us. And then we rely on to a manufacturer wherein we get the ready-made medicine. But how authentic is that medicine? As Ram Manohar sir said, like there are a lot of possibilities that there is an adulteration of raw material. And we at Shri Dudh Papeshwar Limited have even standardized our raw material on par with the phytochemical constituent that be a major point to highlight into that element. And when we say that a manufacturer manufactures a medicine, there might be a small decline in the value. Why? Because there might be some fallacies that a manufacturer develops when he is manufacturing the medicine. So, when we say with regards to a Ayurveda medicine, it should be standardized, safe, efficacious and authentic. Modern medicine says that Ayurveda is a placebo effect. अगर हमारे यहाँ पे कोई पेशेंट ठीक होता है तो आयुर्वेद से ठीक नहीं हुआ, उन्होंने कुछ दिया और ठीक हो गया, ऐसे करके समझ एलोपैथिक डॉक्टर का है. बट आयुर्वेद इज नॉट लाइक दैट. आयुर्वेद हैज वेरी स्ट्रॉन्ग इफेक्ट्स, वेरी वेरी स्ट्रॉन्ग साइड इफेक्ट्स ऑल्सो. सो आयुर्वेद इज नॉट अ प्लेसिबो मेडिसिन. दैट इज वॉट वी आर ट्राइंग टू प्रूव बाय दिस एविडेंस बेस्ड आयुर्वेद. Over here on to the left or the right, you can see it's an insert of a medicine called as augmentin. Now you can see over here that there are so many intricacies that are mentioned over here, right from adverse effects, drug interaction, pharmacology, contraindications, precautions, warning. Do we as an Ayurveda practitioner or an Ayurveda manufacturer look into these aspects of any Ayurveda medicine? There are many Ayurveda medicines who just mention the name of the medicine, the granthadhar and the indications or the ingredients. But have we tried to standardize a drug? like what we have shown over here, this is a Mahayograj Gugul insert of Sri Dhutpapeshwar Limited, which gives you the batch-to-batch consistency, the main ingredients, phytochemical constituents, along with that, how the standardization of the drug has taken place. So, we as a company are trying to come at par with an allopathic pharma company, not to compete with them, but in order to give them an idea that yes, Ayurveda also has these kind of parameters that we judge a medicine before coming into the market. As Sir rightly said in the earlier lecture, that we are an Ayurveda fraternity and we try to blend in with our modern science. But as we have to prove them, aaj hamare yahan pe patient aate hai, wo Google se dawai jo hai, wo search karke aate hai. Sir, isme heavy metals hai, aap mujhe ye dawai de rahe ho, kya isse meri kidney kharab hogi? Sir, kya isse jo hai, wo mujhe aur koi problem ho sakti hai? I have seen an Ayurveda practitioner sending me a medicine or I would say his investigation details where the lead levels were found to be high in his blood. I inquired that the doctor, which medicines are you taking? No, I am taking your Brahatva Chintamani and I suppose Rasaraj Ras. I said, but both the medicines do not have high lead content or do not have lead as or nag as the main ingredient into it. No, then it must be because of some other medicine that I may be taking. This occurs when we do not have any kind of a rationale for what kind of research has been taken place. Now, over here we have shown the mode of action, the safety and efficacy and standardization of our Swarna Bhasma. As we know, Swarna Bhasma is a very intricate medicine because it is used in Swarna Prashan. How many doctors of your sitting have done Swarna Prashan to children? To their own, to their patients, to anybody else? Have we any time seen that which company Swarna Bhasma have we taken? Has that Swarna Bhasma been standardized? What are the standardization parameters that have been put into it? What is the efficacy? What is the bioavailability of that medicine? When we do not know all these answers, maybe we depend upon the scriptures, because it has been mentioned in Ayurveda Samhitas that Swarna Bhasma is Medhya, it is Rasayan. But in Bharat Bhaisajya Ratnakar itself, there are 63 different parts or 63 different methods of manufacturing Swarna Bhasma. Which is the best? Which is standardized? We don't know. And there we try to come up with these kind of evidence-based data. One click onto this QR code and entire standardization report of all these papers will be available to you in downloadable PDF format. My any medicine of Sri Dhutpapeshwar Limited you take, it has a QR code, you scan the QR code and entire standardization data is available to you. Has there been any company in India who can give you those data? If so, please do let us know. These are the institutions that we have collaborated for our research. So right from National Institute of Reproductive Health to IIT Bombay to Parul University, KEM Hospital, Mumbai. These are few of our eminent institutions wherein we conduct our clinical, preclinical trial. As rightly said that we indulge in Ayurveda reverse pharmacology. Why? Because our text has already done the work for the proper clinical research to be done. As mentioned earlier also that Charaka, Shushruta have already mentioned these texts, they have tried, tested on humans. We are just validating the data on the basis of preclinical trials on rats to validate the study. And these institutes have definitely helped us to get into the picture. This is one of the study of Swarna Bhasma that we have done along with Indian Institutes of Technology, Mumbai, under the guidance of chemical technologist Dr. Jayesh Bellare sir and his PhD scholar Dr. Snehashish Biswas. Here we have tried to mention that Swarna Bhasma should be a proper Bhasmikaran process done. In Dhutpapeshwar, we do not use any kind of muffle furnace to give any kind of puttas. We used standardized cow dung cake. So our cow dung cake is also being standardized. as to how much energy should come from one cow dung cake to get me batch to batch consistency. Here we are trying to highlight five competitors' companies where the Swarna Bhasma is formed to be homogeneous, means the proper Bhasmikaran process is not been done. Dr. Jayesh Bellare in his paper has absolutely staunchly written that there are two companies who have not done Bhasmikaran process at all. They may be chemically prepared. I would not like to name the companies, but if you go on to our research papers, I'll later on share you the QR code for those. You can see that many of the companies do not follow authentic standardization procedures, because of which the market value of that goods is less than others' competitors. Moreover, we cannot guarantee onto the efficacy as well as the safety of the medicine. As per allopathic science, if a drug does not pass AIIMS assay, that it does not help into colonization, that drug is reduced down or it is removed from the clinical trial then and there itself. This is a trial that has been conducted of Swarna Bhasma with its genotoxicity and mutagenicity effect. We have even studied Swarna Bhasma up to fourth generation in mice that it does not cause any kind of gene aberration or genetic damage. Here is one study that we have conducted. This is a video, if you can click onto that video. Sir, ye video pe click kijiye. Ye wala. Ye jo. Okay, fine, not an issue. Anxiolytic effect of Swarna Bhasma in zebrafish study. In this, what we have done, these are two tanks. The video is not getting played due to some reason. In one tank, you can see the zebrafish which is going on down. That is called as the lower zone. It is a safe zone. If you have a fish tank at home, you can see that fishes never try to swim up. They will always swim down because they feel safe. Somebody might not catch them. But when Swarna Bhasma was given to this fish, it started to swim in the upper zone. Means the anxiety of the fish starts to reduce down. The similar effect was being seen when alcohol was administered to the fish. So when we say 7 baje ke baad jo hai wo aadmi high ho jata hai, so this is that effect. But you can see that this effect is very transient. Alcohol effect goes down, aadmi wapas zameen pe aa jata hai. But when we had seen this anxiolytic effect by giving Swarna Bhasma, it was consistent in the fish for more than 35 days. That is the effect of Swarna Bhasma that we are trying to prove. So this is an evidence-based Ayurveda that we are trying to see over here. Click. Next slide, please, sir. Next. Slide change. Yes, sir, done. This is another example of our evidence-based Ayurveda. Vasant Kusumakar Ras is a very known drug which is used extensively for treatment or management of diabetes. Wherein we have seen Vasant Kusumakar Ras and pancreatoprotective activity. Means Vasant Kusumakar Ras not only helps to cure diabetes, but it also helps to stimulate your pancreas to regenerate, which is seen as a SIRT1 receptors. These SIRT1 receptors are the ones which are present in many vital organs like brain, liver, pancreas, kidneys. And these receptors, if stimulated, can see that our regeneration of that organ can take place. Vasant Kusumakar Ras, this trial was done where we have conducted even the HbA1c result. And it has been, I would say, correlated with streptozotocin. So with streptozotocin, we had damaged the pancreas. And then we had started with Vasant Kusumakar Ras. And we have seen pre and post histopathological studies in that. And it has been proven that Vasan Kusumakar Ras not only helps to reduce down your sugar levels, but it also helps to stimulate your pancreas. Talking on to the allopathic pathways, we have beta-catenin pathway, which is seen in neuropathy. So when diabetes is prolonged, at that time a neuropathy is developed. When neuropathy develops, this beta-catenin pathway has been initiated. It has been seen that giving Vasan Kusumakar Ras, it helps to reduce down this neuropathy. And in this research, we have collaborated or correlated it with a drug like pregabalin. We know Brihatvaj Chintamani Ras helps in cardioprotection. And similar kind of a research we have done where Brihatvaj Chintamani Ras, where we have our patent molecule, that is Rudrog Chintamani Ras, as a cardioprotective agent. In this, what we had done, we had given mice this Rudrog Chintamani Ras for continuous 28 days. And on 29th day, we had induced them myocardial infarction. And pre and post studies along with cardiac biomarkers was done, wherein we had seen that the low dose and high dose, these are the two slides wherein the histopathological evidence says that when Brihatvaj Chintamani or Rudrog Chintamani was administered to mice, the damage due to myocardial infarction was found to be far less as compared to disease control. This is one of the studies where we use extensive Google in our practice. But if Google Vishesh Shodhan is not done, then it helps or it can generate enteropathies. That is, it can generate even ulcers. And here we have compared it with diclofenac sodium. And we have seen that Vishesh Shodhan Google does not cause any kind of enteropathy. Amla Pitta Mishran. One of the best drug that we can promote in case of Amla Pitta. Here we had earlier conducted our preclinical trial, and this is a pre and post endoscopy that was done by DM gastroenterologist Dr. Manoj Lahote sir of Raipur. So we have not only correlated Ayurveda, but we have taken evidence based from allopathic science also. This is epigastric pain, epigastric tenderness. So when we say that Rutkanta Daha Uro Udor Shul, that is the Ayurveda parameters, or this is the scale that was being developed by Dr. M.S. Baghel sir, and that also we have tried to correlate in our clinical research. Our all research papers are CTRI approved and they are all available on our websites for visibility. Amla Pitta symptom rating scale, so pre and post analysis with the symptoms that we have done. Recently, we have conducted a multicentric study of Amla Pitta Mishran along with Ayurvidya Prasarak Mandal Sion Mumbai and NIA Jaipur, where 204 patients were administered for 1 month and their pre and post analysis was done. This is with regards to one of our patent product, that is Abraloha, wherein we have seen within 4 weeks of time the hemoglobin increases by 2 milligrams per DL, and it has been compared with allopathic drug like ferrous ascorbate. So this is the result. One of the best medicine is an immunomodulator, Swamla compound or Swamla, which is a fortified Chyawanprash, wherein we have seen within 3 months of time, the CD4 cell count of a person also increases. So thus it is even evidently seen that if given even for an immunocompromised patients or an HIV patient, we can see a good amount of increase in the CD4 cell count. This is one study of myostal liniment that we had conducted with Parul University. And for the first time, a US-based instrument called as a muscle dynamometer was used to check the strength of the person's knee. So right and left knee of a diseased as well as a normal person, one with only physiotherapy and one with physiotherapy with myostal liniment application. And wherein we have seen that when myostal along with physiotherapy and liniment application, it has increased the knee strength. So this is the muscle dynamometer that has been seen. And you can see that it has been compared with regards to paracetamol. So it not only reduces pain, but it also strengthens the knee. And when paracetamol was withdrawn, the symptoms did remained almost as it is. But when myostatin was withdrawn, there had been a gradual increase in the improvement seen in the patient. So thank you very much for patient listening. This is our QR code for our book called as Evidence-Based Ayurveda, which can give you access to 34 of our papers which are published in international and national journals. We are ready for any kind of collaboration with any institute or any student. So if so, please do get in touch with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Such an informative lectures. Now I invite today's chairperson, Dr. Vinod Chaudhary, sir, to share the views.
Dr. Shishir ji ne jo व्याख्यान दिया है एविडेंस बेस्ड आयुर्वेद स्टडीज इसके बारे में ऑथेंटिकेशन ऑफ द मेडिसिन इज गारंटी और धूत पापेश्वर जो कंपनी के माध्यम से इन्होंने धूत पापेश्वर इज वेरी फेमस फॉर भस्म उन्होंने कहा था कि धूत पापेश्वर कंपनी इसमें से किसको पता नहीं है तो मुझे याद है कि एक यूनानी के व्यक्ति ने हाथ उठाया था हो सकता है उनको पता नहीं लेकिन बाकी सभी को ये कंपनी पता है इट इज़ वेरी फेमस फॉर दी भस्मास हेवी मेटल्स के बारे में स्वर्ण प्राशन एंड भस्म इसके बारे में उन्होंने बहुत अच्छा 63 मेथड्स टू प्रिपेयर स्वर्ण प्राशन इज वेरी वेल डिस्क्राइब्ड कोलेबरेशन इज ऑल्सो इम्पॉर्टेंट रिगार्डिंग एविडेंस एंजाइटी एंड फ्रिश एंटी एंजाइटी इफेक्ट ऑफ स्वर्ण भस्म उन्होंने बहुत अच्छे से बताया है वसंत कुसुम रस के बारे में भी पैनक्रियो प्रोटेक्टिव एक्शन एंड डायबिटीज इट वाज वेरी गुड स्टडी ऑफ दिस वसंत कुसुम रस अम्लपित्त मिश्रण रिवेल्युएशन एंड इफिकेसी ऑफ अम्लपित्त आयरन डिफिशियंसी एनीमिया स्वामला इम्यूनो स्टिम्युलेंट ये सब जो स्टडीज था उन्होंने अपने माध्यम से बताया मैं इनके व्याख्यान के लिए बहुत अच्छा समझता हूँ इट इज़ राइट स्टार फॉर द लॉन्ग रन थैंक यू आयोजक ने मुझे बुलाया यहाँ पे चेयरमैनशिप दी उसके लिए भी मैं थैंक यू बोलता हूँ धन्यवाद
थैंक यू सर नाउ आई रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर नीता महसेकर मैम टू शेयर देयर व्यूज
सभा में उपस्थित सभी आप्तजनों विद्वत जनों को मेरा नमस्कार यहाँ इट वॉज जस्ट लाइक ए होम कमिंग आई थैंक इनिशियली ओनली टू द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स बिकॉज आई थिंक आई वॉज ऑल्सो ए पार्ट ऑफ दिस आयुर्वेदा टीचर्स अवार्ड सेरेमनी विच हेल्प मी टू गेट दिस इम्पेटेंस टूडे वेयर आई एम सो थैंक यू एटेकॉन एंड आई कॉन्ग्रेचुलेट देम फॉर देयर फ्यूचर सो फॉर द सेशन हियर मैं धन्वंतरी हमारे लॉर्ड को नमन करती हूँ मेरे गुरु को नमन करते हुए यहाँ पर ये कहना चाहूँगी कि डॉक्टर शिशिर ने जो प्रेजेंट किया है आई थिंक इट वाज वंडरफुल क्रिस्प एंड टू द पॉइंट एंड देन वी अंडरस्टैंड द बेस ऑफ आयुर्वेदा द इम्पॉर्टेंस द सिग्निफिकेंस द मेटलर्जी मस्ट हैव डेवलप्ड वन आयन प्रिपरेशन इन भस्म फॉर्म दैट जस्ट अ पाउडर फॉर्म दे से But we have 63 preparations where we say from Bharat Bhaisaj Ratnakar and how much deep we have to evolve to tell it to the world कि हमारे जो आप जिनको त्रिकाल ज्ञानी थे जिनका कोई भी विचार ऐसा नहीं था कि स्वार्थ के लिए हो तो उनके जो evidence based में आज धूत पापेश्वर ला रहे हैं कि उनके माध्यम से हम इनको थैंकफुल रहेंगे व्हेन वी यूज्ड टू स्टडी एट हैदराबाद इट वाज ऑलवेज भस्म कहते ही हम बैद्यनाथ की ओर जाते थे So I'm not discriminating any company, but when meri karma bhumi banti hai Maharashtra, although I belong to Telangana, but here I have seen whenever I wished writing, so it was always Dhut Papeshwar in Bhasma, Gondal, Unja. So these we prefer. Jab liquid ki baat aati hai, to koi aur prefer hota hai. So what all you have told, Dr. Shishir, I think I am a great fan for Myostol being a gynecologist. We always use it very, very safely. Not in osteoarthritic conditions, but we all know how relaxin will damage and will cause problems in walking in the women. And Myostol happens to be the very safest thing. So one by one, I would like to evaluate. So as you said, preventive and curative and rejuvenative, that was the best thing. So rejuvenation, we all know, India is young today, but will be lodging into geriatric needs in the coming future. And with Ayurveda, we can prove it to everyone, like we proved in COVID, we can prove that, yes, our geriatric persons will be more stronger with all these drugs, what we have in Ayurveda as a holistic approach. We cannot say and we cannot match, as rightly said by Dr. Ramji, ki the parameters are there, parameters are different, but we have to come down with our own parameters. And I would also like to share, I was into my PhD, although I did from there, I was into a self-guide mode. From Pune University, I had passed this examination for my PhD. But when I said, why should I talk in parameter of 30 patient, 50 patient or 100 patient? When Ayurveda is customary one-to-one, I was shown the door. Again, I had to come by hook or crook, and I tried convincing. And I am very thankful to Professor Rajderkar sir, who found out all the methodology from Ayurveda side also. And he was then telling me that if you have to complete it, jaisa desh vaisa bhes, jab hum kehte hai, tab jaisa abhi hamara PhD ka pattern hai, aapko complete karna padega. But I felt ki let the world know now what is best for from our side only, instead of pulling across with them. So when we talk about placebo, when you said placebo, it is never a placebo, we all know that, because we depend upon Agni. We cannot say Suvarna Bhasma is used for Rasayan Vajikaran or fetal cardiac activity or where. It is the Vaidya's choice. So it is the world for them to know how best we can do it. So nephrotoxicity and all. So lead ka jo madhyam kaha hai, to ye hum bhi face karte hai when we use Garbhapal Ras, ki lead toxicity. But we all know all their medicines come with a note, disclaimer, liver ke liye toxic hai, phir bhi hum dena chahenge. It is causing nephrotoxicity, still we will give. Even in cancer patients, we have so many disclaimers, still we use. Let the world know through our media, through our vaidyas, that strongly when we put up a show, definitely they have to bend down. So I would also talk about reverse pharmacology from Dhut Papeshwar way. Yes, they are working a very great way in this. So genotoxis or ye jo zebra fresh, I think I'm thankful you have become my guru there now, because I learned this zebra fresh. Suddenly something, things come to my mind that now we will adopt this model, and we would like to invite, I have talked to Puranik sir also, to Nia, definitely we would like to do with Artemisia, we have in plenty, we have bamboo in plenty. So I would like to give no substitute in Ayurveda for Tavakshir. We will develop that. I said ki I am going to develop there at Nia. So that will be a helpful way from sir also. So definitely Vasanta Kusumakar, as we say, there is no other match for pancreatic cancer, lest we use this product. And if there is nothing from that side also, why not promote our own medications? And with Amla Pitta Mishran, Abhrak Bhasma, mainly what you said, CD4 count for Swamla. Yes, Swamla increases HIV aya, to humare liye boon tha, ki hum wahan par present kar sake. But Swamla, if the Agni is good, then only we give in all this. Agni Aam Mal. जो हम कहते हैं कि आम का जो पैरामीटर है, हम उसके पैरामीटर पे जब चलते हैं तभी हम कुछ और प्रूव कर पाएंगे. इन्हीं शब्दों के साथ मैं नमस्कार कहूंगी सभी के लिए. धन्यवाद.
थैंक यू मैम. नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर अरुण दुधमले सर टू फेलिसिटेट स्पीकर ऑफ दिस सेशन डॉक्टर सुशांत पाटिल सर विथ मोमेंटो एंड सर्टिफिकेट अ टोकन ऑफ लव. Like to request Dr. Veena Patil ma'am to facilitate chairperson of this session Dr. Maisekar ma'am with certificate and memento of love. Request Dr. Prashant Dalvi sir to facilitate chairperson of this session Dr. Vinod Chaudhary sir. Now time is vote of thanks. Thank you so much Dr. Sushant Patil sir for very informative talk. Thank you for sharing time with us on our platform. Thank you Dr. Maisekar ma'am for sharing your views and giving to your precious times apart from your schedules. I am very thankful Dr. Vinod Chaudhary sir to give a precious time. Thank you sir. I am very thankful for ATA for organizing the events and giving me a chance of sharing the stage. Thank you over this session. Now I hand over Dr. Sonia Dahat ma'am.
Thank you so much sir and ma'am. To facilitate our session coordinator, I would like to invite Dr. Praveen Joshi sir and Dr. Nilesh Bakal sir on stage. Please sir. I request Dr. Prashant Khade sir, please come on the stage and to facilitate our session coordinator. Please sir. Uncle Dikambar sir and Pallavi Pardeshi ma'am, please do come. Dr. Prashant Khade sir, please on the stage sir. It was such an informative session. Thank you, panel, for sharing their experts' view and experiences with us. Thank you, Dr. Pallavi Pardeshi ma'am and Dr. Ankur Dikondwar sir, for coordinating these sessions.
Now, we will have an insightful session with Dr. Narayan Jadhav sir. We invite Dr. Rita Mandle madam to coordinate this session. Dr. Rita Mandle madam is assistant professor in Dravyagun department at Sumati Bai Shah Ayurved Mahavidyalay, Hadapsar, Pune. Dr. Rita madam, please start your session.
Thank you so much, sir. Good afternoon, all of you. Today's session is on ethics and legal aspects in Ayurvedic profession. For this, we have an eminent speaker, Dr. Narayan Jadhav sir. So I inviting Narayan Jadhav sir, please come on the stage. In addition to this, I cordially invite our chairperson, Dr. Veena Patil ma'am, to please join us. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. To start this session, I would like to introduce our chairperson, Dr. Veena Patil ma'am. He is a professor and HOD of Sri Rog and Prasuti Tantra, Government Ayurved College, Usmanabad. Currently working as an assistant director, Ayush, administrative officer, Ayush Pune. She is also HOD, Ayurved department, Sassoon Hospital, Pune. Ma'am has 30 years of experience in teaching. More than 80 research papers are published in peer review journals and also on editorial boards of international journals. Ma'am also play a role as an honorable member in Marathwada Sports Committee. Ma'am has awarded Sahyadri Sri Shakti Puraskar for excellent work in health and humanity on 2017. Ma'am got an award for best teacher in 2021 by All India Institute of Teachers Association. I welcome you, ma'am, and thanks for honoring here. Let me introduce our speaker, Dr. Narayan Jadhav sir. Thank you, sir, for coming here. This session is on ethics and legal aspects. Sir has a master's in this ethics and legal aspect. Sir is a member of board of ethics and registration, NCISM Ministry of Ayush, New Delhi. Sir has 70-year experience in teaching experience at Dhanvantari Ayurved Medical College, Udgir, Latur, and also 23 years clinical experience. Sir has played a major role as a member in committee on draft regulation for ethics and registration, NCISM. Also experts on Ayurvedic suggestions and Siddha suggestions on draft regulations for ethics and registration at NCISM, New Delhi. Sir has done additional responsibility by NCISM, Ministry of Ayush, Government of India, as a nodal officer for Hindi Rajbhasha Vibhag, NCISM, also secretary in charge, and also the member of technical bid opening committee, old record digitalization and maintenance committee, institute verification committee also. More than 35 research papers are published in national and international journals and also presented 25 research papers. Sir has contribution in various book chapters in various subjects, including Dravyaguna also. He has great work on Nasya Panchakarma, which is noted in the Guinness World Record, and also participated in International Book of Records for his work on largest class of Charak Sanhita. Overall, sir has a expertise in all fields, and it's our pleasure to hear you, sir. I'm requesting Dr. Narayan Jadhav sir, please continue the session. Thank you.
Namaskar. Good afternoon, everybody. Respected chairperson, Dr. Veena madam, all the dignitaries present over here. Sarvapratham, Sarva Gurujanana Namaskar. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo, Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat, Parabrahmam, Tasmay Sri Guruve Namaha. Aaj is Ayurveda Future 2050. I am very much thankful to the organizers, ETA, Ayurveda Teachers Association. I have been associated with this association since its beginning. That's why I came here. Dr. Rahul ji asked me, sir, you should hear. I am not very expert in this subject, but when these four subjects, Ayurveda Academia, industry, research and practice, जब राहुल जी ने मुझे बोला कि सर आपको आना है तो ये चार सब्जेक्ट और इतने बड़े बड़े वक्ता और मैं तो अभी नया खिलाड़ी हूँ तो इसमें मैं क्या कर सकता हूँ लेकिन पिछले एक साल से आप सभी की शुभेच्छा से मैं एनसीएसएम में बोर्ड ऑफ एथिक्स एंड रजिस्ट्रेशन में एक मेंबर का दायित्व निभा रहा हूँ फिर मैंने सोचा क्यों नहीं इस एक साल का ही क्यों नहीं थोड़ा बहुत अनुभव हम यहाँ पे साझा करें क्योंकि फ्यूचर ऑफ आयुर्वेद अगर है तो मैं मानता हूँ पहले फ्यूचर ऑफ आयुर्वेद इज अ टीचर ऑफ आयुर्वेद क्योंकि आयुर्वेद का फ्यूचर हम जब तय करने जाते हैं तो टीचर ही बहुत ही इम्पोर्टेंट है और मुझे लगता है यहाँ पर बहुत सारे सीनियर टीचर्स हैं यहाँ पर उसके बाद स्टूडेंट क्योंकि चार ही घटक यहाँ पर डिस्कस किए और ये सेशन अभी लंच के पहले का सेशन है मैं मानता हूं टाइटल में लीगल इथिकल एंड लीगल एस्पेक्ट्स इन आयुर्वेद प्रोफेशन ये तीन बातें हैं एक तो आयुर्वेद प्रोफेशन उसका इथिकल एस्पेक्ट एंड उसके बाद उसका लीगल एस्पेक्ट आप सभी को पता है 2012 एक भोपाल में पांचवा वर्ल्ड आयुर्वेद कांग्रेस हो रहा था और वहीं पे 2012 में मैं फर्स्ट अटेंड करने गया था तो वहां पे डॉक्टर विजय भटकर आप सभी को पता है उन्होंने एक विजन और एक बात कही कि जिस तरह से आईटी इंडस्ट्री पूरे वर्ल्ड में अपना प्रोमिनेंसी दिखा रही है इंडियन आईटी उसी तरह से अगर हम अच्छी तरह से एकेडमिया रिसर्च इंडस्ट्री एंड प्रैक्टिस ये चारों कंपोनेंट अगर हम अच्छी तरह से विथ इथिकल एंड लीगल एस्पेक्ट हम अगर आगे बढ़े तो आने वाला समय हमारा ही होगा हेल्थ केयर इंडस्ट्री में या हेल्थ केयर की जब वर्ल्ड में बात होगी तब आयुष स्पेशली आयुर्वेद और योगा की बात होगी ऐसा एक विजन उन्होंने यहाँ पे उद्धृत किया था इसी की कड़ी में अभी जो भी कुछ चल रहा है आप सभी को पता है अभी हम आज़ादी का अमृत महोत्सव मना रहे हैं और अगला 25 साल का अपना अमृत काल है तो ये प्रोफेशन के हमारे फ्यूचर है ये दो स्टेटमेंट्स है दूसरा स्टेटमेंट है कि थ्रू द आयुष सेक्टर India will go to the world and the entire world will come to the India. On these two statements, there are two policies are formulated. One is Heal in India and Heal by India. Heal in India. Foreigners come to India for their wellness or treatment and Ayurvedic experts go to the world for Ayurvedic treatment, healed by India. तो ये दो स्टेटमेंट से दो पॉलिसी अभी बन रही है तो इसमें हमारे जो भी यंग टीचर्स है या स्टूडेंट्स है इसे दोनों भी इसमें इन्वॉल्व हो सकते हैं बैकग्राउंड वी ऑल नो व्हाट इज मीन बाय प्रोफेशन इट इज अ टाइप ऑफ करियर और ऑक्यूपेशन that requires specialized education, training and knowledge in a particular field. Profession requires a license or certification or accreditation
to practice legally and specially regulated by professional association or governing body. Abhi sab hamare teacher bandhu do baaton pe bahut dhyan de rahe hain. Ek to NAC ka accreditation institute ka aur dusra hospital ka NABH accreditation. To uske liye ye bahut important hai. ये होल आयुर्वेद सिस्टम पूरे बेसिक प्रिंसिपल सिस्टम में आप सभी को पता है. अब आयुर्वेद प्रोफेशन की बात आने के बाद प्रैक्टिस मेनली प्रैक्टिस रिलेटेड अगर हम देखें तो मोस्ट ऑफ द महाराष्ट्र की अगर बात करें तो जनरल प्रैक्टिस वो भी मॉडर्न मेडिसिन की प्रैक्टिस अपने पास होती है. नियर अबाउट 1,00,000 प्रैक्टिशनर्स है हमारे पास. उसके बाद कुछ लोग इंटीग्रेटेड प्रैक्टिस करते हैं, कुछ आयुर्वेद की प्योर प्रैक्टिस करते हैं, कुछ आयुर्वेद स्पेशलिटी की प्रैक्टिस करते हैं अष्टांग आयुर्वेद के तहत, कुछ लोग सुपर स्पेशलिटी की भी प्रैक्टिस कर रहे हैं. और सेकंड थिंग इंटीग्रेटिव मेडिसिन एक एस्पेक्ट अभी आया है. तो ये प्रैक्टिस के हमारे अलग अलग प्रकार है. उसके बाद एकेडमिक्स टीचिंग रिसर्च और इंडस्ट्री ये चारों से रिलेटेड अगर इथिक्स की बात करना है तो बहुत बड़ा सब्जेक्ट है, उतना हम उसके डीप नहीं जाएंगे. अभी हमने रिसर्च के बारे में फ्यूचर रोड मैप भी देखा है और ड्रग रिसर्च का भी हमने बहुत अच्छा व्याख्यान हमने अभी सुना है. तो प्रेजेंट स्टेटस अभी आयुष का विचार करें तो नियर अबाउट 7,00,000 प्रैक्टिशनर्स अभी आयुष में है. उसके बाद अगर इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर की बात करें तो दिस इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर इज रेगुलेटेड बाय नेटवर्क ऑफ कॉलेजेस पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट्स इंस्टीट्यूशंस रिसर्च सेंटर्स एंड हॉस्पिटल्स. इंडिया ऑफर्स अ डाइवर्स बास्केट ऑफ हेल्थ केयर सर्विसेज टू पेशेंट बियॉन्ड एलोपैथी. हमारे पास एक बड़ा बास्केट है उसमें AYSHU आयुष 5 प्लस आगे इसमें 2-7 अलग अलग पैथी है. बहुत बड़ा बास्केट हमारे सामने है, वहाँ से हमको जो भी लेना है अकॉर्डिंग टू अवर रिक्वायरमेंट हम ले सकते हैं. ऐसा बास्केट वर्ल्ड में किसी के पास अवेलेबल नहीं है. और आपको सबको पता है पोस्ट कोविड के बाद अभी सबका रुझान या सबका लाइफस्टाइल मॉडिफिकेशन की तरफ हो रहा है. आई सर्विस आई एम नॉट गोइंग इन टू द डिटेल्स. आई सर्विस आप सबको पता है अभी इसका आयुष रैंकिंग अगर रेवेन्यू का बात करें तो टॉप मोस्ट 5th सर्विस अभी आयुष की सर्विस हुई है. और मेडिकल वैल्यू ट्रैवल में इंडिया इज एक्सपेक्टेड टू 13 बिलियन अभी 22 का ये एस्टिमेट है. इनेबलिंग एनवायरनमेंट अभी बहुत अच्छा पोषक है. मैं ज़्यादा इसके ऊपर भी बात नहीं करूँगा. इंटरनेशनल कोलाबरेशंस बहुत ही अच्छी अपॉर्चुनिटी अभी यंग जनरेशन को है. अवर मिनिस्ट्री हैव कंट्री टू कंट्री मेमोरेंडम ऑफ एसोसिएशन 25 कंट्री के साथ हुआ है. कोलाबरेशन 36 अलग अलग इंटरनेशनल बॉडीज के साथ रिसर्च के लिए हुआ है. 16 आयुष चेयर्स सेटअप हुए हैं. उसके बाद 38 कंट्री में आयुष इंफॉर्मेशन सेल भी इस्टेब्लिश हुआ है. और मेडिकल वैल्यू ट्रैवल अभी G20 के साथ उसके साथ भी काम चल रहा है. ग्लोबल इन्वेस्टमेंट पिछले साल जो एक गांधीनगर में एक समिट हुआ था उसी में ही ये डिक्लेयर हुआ है. अभी 17-18 को अगला समिट होने जा रहा है वहाँ पे. अदर कोलाबरेशंस साइंड ए प्रोजेक्ट कोलाबरेशन अग्रीमेंट विथ हु. अभी ये बेंचमार्क भी WHO ने निकाला है कि हाउ टू प्रैक्टिस आयुर्वेद एट इंटरनेशनल लेवल. एंड सेकेंड बेंचमार्क इज हाउ टू गिव द ट्रेनिंग टू द फॉरेनर्स विदाउट नो एनी कॉम्प्रोमाइज इन द बेसिक प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ आयुर्वेद. एंड थर्ड थिंग इज सेकेंड मॉड्यूल ऑफ ट्रेडिशनल मेडिसिन चैप्टर ICD इंक्लूडेड इन ICD इंटरनेशनल क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ डिसीज 11. एंड नेक्स्ट थिंग इज इंटरनेशनल फार्माकोपिया फॉर हर्बल मेडिसिन. इट्स अ वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग क्योंकि रिसर्च के लेक्चर में राम मनोहर सर जो बात कर रहे थे उसी में वही प्रॉब्लम है हमारे ड्रग रिसर्च के बारे में, तो और एक पॉलिसी वहां पे आ रही है, वन ड्रग वन मोनोग्राफ, इट मे बी इन एनी सिस्टम, इट मे बी मॉडर्न सिस्टम, इट मे बी सिद्धा, इट मे बी आयुर्वेद, इट मे बी सोवारिकपा, वन हर्बल ड्रग वन मोनोग्राम वन स्टैंडर्डाइजेशन। आयुष इन पब्लिक हेल्थ, आप सभी को पता है नेशनल आयुष मिशन स्कोप एंड पोटेंशियल्स कैन अट्रैक्ट न्यू हाई वैल्यू पेशेंट्स फ्रॉम OECD कंट्रीज, फुल स्पेक्ट्रम क्रेडिबल हेल्थ केयर, इंडियाज USP एज अ हेल्थ केयर डेस्टिनेशन, नीड टू डिफरेंशिएट फ्रॉम कंपीटिंग मेडिकल वैल्यू ट्रैवल डेस्टिनेशन, बिल्ड ब्रांड इंडिया एज अ हेल्थ डेस्टिनेशन। वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग इज आयुष इज अवर सॉफ्ट पावर, the global healthcare and lifestyle preferences moving towards holistic health, preventive care, non-radical treatments, therapeutic care and sustainable health, in line with WHO vision for preventive and holistic care, Ayush poised to become the face of Indian healthcare and traditional globally needs to be branded very strongly. Very important thing, Ayush Ayurved kahan kahan hum practice kar sakte hain aur kar rahe hain, एक नंबर प्री एक्यूट स्टेज में एज अ प्रिवेंटिव एंड एज अ क्यूरेटिव, एक्यूट एलिवेटिव प्रिवेंटिव केयर में भी हम काम कर सकते हैं। हमारा प्रॉब्लम खाली इमरजेंसी मैनेज में है, बाकी पोस्ट एक्यूट और प्रिवेंट क्योर में भी हम कर सकते हैं, और बाकी मेन स्ट्रीम मेडिकल कंडीशंस वी ऑल नो, क्योंकि पुणे तिथे काय उने, पुणे हे आयुर्वेदाचं माहेर घर आहे, मला जास्त त्याच्याबद्दल बोलायची गरज नाही, कारण एवढ्या सगळ्या क्रॉनिक डिसीजेसमध्ये आयुर्वेद हा सिद्ध झालेला आहे। टर्शरी केयर में आयुर्वेद क्या कर सकता है, जैसा दिल्ली में मेदांता हॉस्पिटल है, बेंगलोर में निमहंस है, अभी एम्स है, ये पूरे टर्शरी केयर हॉस्पिटल्स में आयुर्वेद का विंग खुला है, और वो पूरे पूरे क्रिटिकल केसेस में, मैंने खुद जाके देखा है, क्रिटिकल केसेस में आफ्टर रोबोटिक सर्जरी और आफ्टर एनी सर्जरी और आफ्टर एनी इंटरवेंशन दे आर इंट्रोड्यूसिंग आवर ट्रीटमेंट्स, that it is very much potential of our students for functional health। functional health mein abhi bhi hamare counterpart ke paas kuch nahi hai, usme stress, sleep, bowel, digestion, motility, isme hamare hi medicine acche kaam karte hai, quality of life sudharne ke liye bhi hamare treatment acche hai, as a adjuvant therapy, uske baad जो भी कुछ intervention के बाद भी हम हमारे treatments हम introduce कर सकते हैं, उसके लिए appropriately integrated through care cycle, these are the professional potentials before our students or our graduates। we want to building brand Ayurveda and yoga, ye pure decisions mein hum brand create ho raha hai aur kar sakte hai। wellness economy ka hum baat karenge, तो इंडिया अभी वेलनेस इकोनॉमी साइज में 12 नंबर पे है, ग्रॉस जीडीपी में अगर बात करें तो 6 नंबर पे है, पॉपुलेशन की रैंक सेकंड में है, और पर कैपिटा की बात करें तो 128 नंबर पे है। दिस इज आवर टारगेट। नाउ इथिक्स, वी ऑल नो आयुर्वेदोपदेशेषु विधेया परमादरा। इथिक्स की बात अगर हम करेंगे तो हमारे पूरे संहिता में शुरुआत से लेके उसके एंड तक पूरा इथिक्स का खजाना है। मैं बहुत छोटा आदमी हूँ उसके बारे में बात करने के लिए, लेकिन आप सबको पता है इथिक्स, moral code of conduct defining the right and wrong behavior in a civil society, it comes from within। hum subah uthne se leke pure neend jane tak pura ethical part aata hai, aur waisa hi hamare practice mein, waisa hi hamare vyavsay mein, waisa hi industry mein, aur waisa hi research mein hona chahiye। medical ethics, western medical ethics are guided by 4 central themes, we all know autonomy, beneficency, non malficency and justice, this is the principalism, it has been developed by Bicham and Childress, promoted by the Ron Gilon USA 1970 mein iska shuruaat hua, popularly accepted by the medical world as a set of universal guidelines for bioethics. Abhi research ki baat ho rahi thi, universal acceptance should be there. So uske liye theories are important merit. Autonomy. Agar autonomy ki hum baat kare, to hamare isme vaidya vritti bataya hai. Maitri, karunya marteshu, sakshet arpiti upekshanam. Yeah, autonomy is nothing but the self-law or self-governance. Chatuspa, we all know. Dravya anupasthata rogi patu pada chatustayam. Vishat dravya upasthata or rogi. Ye char pad, chikisa ke char ang hai, iske siva chikisa hi nahi ho sakti. These are the examples, best example of our Sushruta Acharya. Beside these, Vidya, Vitarko, Vijnanam, Samrati, Tatparataha, Kriya. These are the qualities, those imbibed in the physician. Beneficency. It's duty always to act in the best interest of patient or the action that is done for the benefit of others. Acharya Sushruta ka Yogya Sutra. Ayurveda ki training, practical training, theoretical training, hands-on experience, kaisi honi chahiye. Aur ye kyun honi chahiye? To patient ke benefit ke liye honi chahiye. Non-malficency. It means not harm or not risk. Medical services of the healthcare professionals reach the optimum standard of patient care through proper training, competent and acquired skill. In healthcare, harm could be pain, dysfunction or death. However, broader definition of harm is often required in ethical consideration. This principle includes not doing harm, preventing harm, and removing harmful condition. In our text, in Panchakarma, especially Panchakarma Siddhi Adhyaya, each and every intervention in our Shastra is defined very well ethically. Panchakarma ka indication, contraindication, yogya, ayogya. Yogya, ayogya ke baad, agar panchakarma karne ke samay kuch dikkati hui, uske baad vyapat ka bhi varnan kiya hai. Vyapat ke baad uski chikitsa ka bhi varnan kiya hai. To no harm. Justice. It involves being fair in allocation of resources and in the physician's obligation in the patient. According to this principle, all persons in the society should be treated fairly. Sushruta advised the physician that he should be in easy reach of all people. Easily available hona chahiye hamara physician, especially the poor ones who may not have the courage to come to the physician easily. Aur dusri baat, Shukla Vastra. Hamare Vastra kaise rehne chahiye? Abhi jo white coat ya apron ki baat hai, to Shukla Vastra. Hamare Vaidyo ne kitni, yane dressing sense bhi kitna hai, ya according to our duty, humne wo karna hai. Uske baad, wishing God of all in world I need, Kalyanam Abhivaren, Bahu Bandhuten. My patient I treat with as like a son. Hum sabko pata hai, Bratri and Lagutri ka agar hum baat kare to pura ye ethics ke saath bhara hai. Ek sutra hai, Madhava Nidhane Shrestha, Sutra Sthane Tu Vagbata, Sharire Susruta Charakastu Chikitsate. Our researcher should go through all these clinical guidelines. Next, please. ethical guidelines for modern type of research. Next, please. Here, my board, Board of Ethics and Registration, vision of the board. You all know the NCISM is constituted under the 18th section, NCISM Act 2020, and in which there are four autonomous boards constituted under the 18th section. The vision of our board is to facilitate maintenance of a national register of Indian system of medicine and enforces high ethical standards in all aspects of Ayurveda, Unani, Siddha, and Sowa Rigpa, professional conduct and medical services. What is our mission? Our board is working in these five directions: to maintain the national register, to regulate the professional conduct and promote medical ethics, and to develop the mechanism to have continuous interaction with the state medical council, to exercise the appellate jurisdiction with respect to the actions taken by the state medical council, to adapt the changing needs and create an effective grievance redressal mechanism. Next, please. Powers and functions: to maintain national register, regulate professional conduct and promote medical ethics, and exercise appellate jurisdiction. Next, please. Important thing is here, rights of the ISM practitioners. What are the rights given by this act to our physicians or practitioners? To practice the profession in registered state only. To add professional designation to his name. To add the list of recognized medical qualification to his name. आज भी हमारे physicians, हमारे doctors बहुत सारी degrees अपने सामने लगाते हैं, तो वो degree ये act के तहत recognized होना चाहिए, वैसी ही degree हमने हमारे सामने लगाना है. BMS, MD, PhD. उसके बाद अगर कोई expertise है तो भी हम नीचे mention कर सकते, लेकिन अपने सामने नहीं लगा सकते, तो इसको भी हम कृपया ध्यान रखें. To choose patient, to seek government medical appointments, to perform surgical operations in extent of his or her teaching and training as per the syllabi, as per the provision prescribed by the state and central government only. हम tall claim नहीं कर सकते, हम जो भी कुछ हमारे training के सिवा हम बाहर नहीं जाना चाहिए. Even specially being a physician, being a practitioner, बहुत बार ऐसे होता है हमारा BMS वैद्य या MD वैद्य कोई भी सब्जेक्ट में रहता है, क्लिनिकल, नॉन क्लिनिकल वगैरह वगैरह. हम हमारे इधर अगर बात करें तो संहिता के इसमें हम कोई भी सब्जेक्ट हमारा नॉन क्लिनिकल नहीं है, ऐसा मानते भी हैं हम. लेकिन जब ये एक्ट की बात आती है, लीगल की बात आती है, तो हमने हमारे स्पेशलिटी में ही काम करना है. मित्रों, आगे जाके अभी तक क्या होता था, कोई बहुत कम लोग आयुर्वेद प्रैक्टिस करते थे. हालांकि मैं भी 22-23 साल पहले एक ग्रेजुएट था, तो आयुर्वेदिक प्रैक्टिस शुरू किया, तो मेरे पास सब पेशेंट आते थे A to Z. जब वो ठीक था, मूलव्याध से लेके, स्पाइन से लेके, न्यूरो से लेके, सब जनरल से लेके सब पेशेंट आते थे. अभी भी आते हैं लोगों के पास, लेकिन अभी हम ग्लोबलाइजेशन की बात कर रहे, इंटरनेशनल प्लेटफॉर्म पे जाने की बात कर रहे, तो हम भी हमारे सब्जेक्ट में स्टिक रह के और उसी को ही डेवलप करना चाहिए. ये लीगली और इथिकली आगे जाके कुछ प्रॉब्लम्स आ सकते हैं. अभी जहाँ पे कोई करता ही नहीं, अभी हमारे उदगीर की अगर बात करें 20-22 साल की पहली, तो मुझे लोग ने हंसा था. मैं जब ग्रेजुएट होके उदगीर में एज ए मेडिकल ऑफिसर बोल के काम किया, आदरणीय बोरसे सर हैं यहाँ पे, 2001 में मेरा इनका मुलाकात हुआ था केरल में ट्रेनिंग के साथ. तो जब मैं प्लेन BMS था, तो वो प्रैक्टिस स्टार्ट करने के बाद लोग हंसते थे कि तुम क्यों कर रही है, इधर नहीं चलता. मेरे BMS बांधवी मुझे हंसते थे. नियर अबाउट 50 लोग उदगीर में प्रैक्टिस करते थे BMS की, जब की बात है. अभी तो 110-112 कुछ है, एक एक तालुका प्लेस में. जब मैंने कॉलेज में मेडिकल ऑफिसर बोल के ज्वाइन करके, अभी अगर आयुर्वेद में ही प्रैक्टिस करना है तो कॉलेज में रहना अच्छा है. कॉलेज के साथ रहे तो थोड़ा पढ़ाई होगा, थोड़ा ट्रेनिंग होगा, थोड़ा कुछ ना कुछ होगा. उसके लिए मैंने वो चॉइस किया था, वो फील्ड. तो मेडिकल ऑफिसर काम करते करते, ट्रेनिंग लेते लेते, फिर लोग हंसने लगे कि बोले क्यों ये क्यों करते तुम ऐसा. तो मैं जब थोड़ा फॉर्म में था, गुरु की कृपा थी, डॉक्टर यादैया सर, डॉक्टर बाजोरिया सर मेरे गुरु, यूजी के गुरु है, वो थोड़ा सा ये था. और कट्टी सर का भी कुछ मुझे अनुभव औरंगाबाद में काम करने से मिला था, एक 6 महीने उनके साथ था. तो थोड़ा सा वो हिसाब से हम प्रैक्टिस कर रहे थे. तो मुझे थोड़ा सा मेरे क्रॉस किया एक सीनियर ने कि आयुर्वेद क्या करेगा. मैंने ऐसे ही बोल दिया उसको कि 4-5 साल में मैं ही बताता तुझे आयुर्वेद क्या करेगा. और 4-5 साल के बाद स्पाइन का पेशेंट बन के मेरे पास आया और मैंने उसको बस्ती देते टाइम उसको ये बात सुनाई. आपको पर्टिकुलरली मैं उसको ये करना चाहता हूँ क्योंकि जब मैंने बस्ती शुरू किया उसको, जब मैं बोला कि आपने ऐसा बोला था भाई साहब, तो फिर वो मान गए. बाद में उन्होंने बहुत अच्छा अभी आयुर्वेद के लिए सपोर्ट भी कर रहे हो. तो ऐसी परिस्थिति हमारी इसमें है. नेक्स्ट प्लीज, नेक्स्ट प्लीज. हाँ, अभी यहाँ पे मेरा स्टार्ट होता है विषय कि हम अभी क्या कर रहे हैं. प्रैक्टिशनर के राइट्स को प्रोटेक्ट करने के लिए एनसीआईएसएम क्या करता है. बहुत छोटी छोटी बातें और बहुत बड़ी बड़ी बातें भी बहुत हमारे पास रोज कुछ ना कुछ आरटीआई में आता है, ग्रीवेंसेस में आते हैं, कभी पीएमओ ऑफिस से आता है, कभी मिनिस्ट्री से आता है, कभी पर्सनली आता है, कभी और किसी से आता है. तो इसमें मेडिकल फिटनेस सर्टिफिकेट का बहुत, अभी भी हमारा कंट्री बहुत डाइवर्स है हम सबको पता है, और हेल्थ इज अ स्टेट सब्जेक्ट बोल के हम बहुत सारे छुटकारे पाते हैं. यस सर, कितना. तो इसमें हमने अभी तक कुछ करस्पॉन्डेंस किया प्रिंसिपल सेक्रेटरी को मेडिकल सर्टिफिकेट के बारे में, क्योंकि बीएमएस डिग्री या आईएसएम की डिग्री, ये डिग्री इज क्वालिफाइड और इज रिकॉग्नाइज्ड बाय द एनसीआईएसएम एक्ट और आईएमसीसी एक्ट विच इज पास्ड बाय द पार्लियामेंट ऑफ इंडिया. दैट्स वाई वी आर द लीगली ग्रेजुएट्स ऑफ मेडिसिन. तो हम उनको दोहराते हैं उसके कोर्ट, उसमें उस एक्ट के कोटिंग्स दे के लेटर भेज के फिर वो मानते हैं, क्योंकि वहाँ पे ब्यूरोक्रेट्स है, पूरे आईएएस ऑफिसर्स वगैरह है, उनको ये इसके बारे में ज़्यादा कुछ पता नहीं है. तो हमको इसका एहसास भी करवाना पड़ता है. सेकंड, अभी यहाँ पुणे से ही एक लेटर आया था, डिनाइल ऑफ द रिजेक्शन डिसऑनर ऑफ हेल्थ क्लेम बाय आवर वन ईएनटी सर्जन, आई थिंक ऑप्थाल्म सर्जन, पुणे से ही आया था. फिर इसके लिए हमको 20-15 दिन पूरा ढूंढना पड़ा, पूरा इंश्योरेंस अथॉरिटी से भी कुछ लेना पड़ा, और बाद में चेयरमैन इंश्योरेंस रेगुलेटरी अथॉरिटी ऑफ इंडिया हैदराबाद को लेटर लिख के, फिर उन्होंने अभी आयुष ट्रीटमेंट और आयुष सर्जरीज भी इसमें अब क्लेम के लिए मान्य किया इन्होंने. और एक बात हमारे सामने आई, एक प्रैक्टिशनर भेजा कि एमबीबीएस डॉक्टर या जो डॉक्टर एमसीआई और एनएमसी के अंडर रजिस्टर्ड है उनको डिस्काउंट दिया जाता है एयरलाइंस में, हमारे ग्रेजुएट्स को नहीं दिया जाता है. तो हमने इसके लिए चेयरमैन जो इंडिगो के एयरलाइंस चेयरमैन है उनको भी लेटर लिखा है कि वो हम भी हमारे एक्ट के तहत ग्रेजुएट है, हमको भी ये हक मिलना चाहिए. उसके बाद आईसीएमआर में एक जगह निकली थी साइंटिस्ट बी ग्रुप, उसमें हमारे क्वालिफिकेशन को लोगों ने नॉन मेडिकल पोस्ट बोल के लिखा था. तो हमने उसको भी डायरेक्टर आईसीएमआर को लेटर लिख के कहा कि हम कैसे क्या नॉन मेडिकल हो सकते हैं. उसके बाद अभी भी एक ओडिशा से लेटर आया है कि वो एपिडेमियोलॉजिस्ट की पोस्ट है, उसमें भी नॉन मेडिकल ग्रेजुएट बोल के लिखा है, उनको भी हमने लेटर लिखा है. एक अरुणाचल प्रदेश से लेटर आया था कि वो हमारा डॉक्टर मेडिकल ऑफिसर अरुणाचल प्रदेश में क्या 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 वो इमरजेंसी कर सकता है, क्या वो पोस्टमार्टम कर सकता है, क्या वो वीआईपी के जो ट्रीटमेंट का उनका जो ताफा रहता है उसमें सहभाग हो ले सकता है क्या. तो उसी को भी हमने जवाब दिया है, उन्होंने भी वो माना है. नेक्स्ट प्लीज. ड्यूटीज ऑफ द प्रैक्टिशनर. तो आप सभी प्रैक्टिशनर हैं, आपको सब पता है. अभी थोड़ा टाइम का ये रहने से मैं आगे चलता हूँ. नेक्स्ट प्लीज. हाउ टू मेडिकल अवॉइड मेडिकल निग्लिजेंसी. ये भी बहुत क्रूशियल टॉपिक है, लेकिन आप सबको पता है कि हम हमारे दायरे में काम करना है, हमारे एक्सपर्टीज में काम करना है, हमारे विषय में काम करना है. तो निग्लिजेंसी या मेडिकल प्रॉब्लम्स आने की कोई शक्यता नहीं रहती है. नेक्स्ट प्लीज, नेक्स्ट प्लीज, नेक्स्ट प्लीज. हाँ, हमको हर एक ग्रेजुएट को हमारा NCISM एक्ट पता होना चाहिए, IMCC एक्ट पता होना चाहिए, और कंसर्न्ड स्टेट मेडिकल प्रैक्टिशनर्स एक्ट इन महाराष्ट्र, MMP एक्ट 1961। तो ये हमारा बिल्कुल आद्य कर्तव्य है कि ये हमने इस कोई भी ठीक है हमको कोई जनरल प्रैक्टिस करो, कोई स्पेशल करो या कोई ये करो, या हमको पता ही बीइंग अ रजिस्टर मेडिकल प्रैक्टिशनर अगर प्रैक्टिस छोड़ के दूसरा कुछ करना है तो ये इसका नई जानकारी रखी तो भी कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं आएगा। नेक्स्ट प्लीज। क्लिनिकल इस्टेब्लिशमेंट एक्ट, ये सब अभी जो भी एक्ट है ये लिस्ट है पूरी, तो हम इस पर काम कर रहे हैं। और एक बात मुझे बताना चाहिए, पिछले 2-5-6 महीने से हम काम कर रहे हैं इसके ऊपर। कोई भी एक्ट लिया और एक्ट का पूरा डिटेल्ड स्टडी करने के बाद उसमें रजिस्टर्ड मेडिकल प्रैक्टिशनर और मेडिकल प्रैक्टिशनर, लीगली मेडिकल प्रैक्टिशनर अगर बोले तो एक ही एक्ट की बात होती है। दोज यहाँ पे रोहित सर बैठे हैं, तो यहाँ पे जो MCI में 1956 में रजिस्टर है और जो NMC 2090 में रजिस्टर है वही चले गए। ऐसे 50 एक्ट हमने ढूंढ के निकाले हैं, अभी वो काम चालू है कि वहां पे इंक्लूजन ऑफ दिस ISM प्रैक्टिशनर शुड बी देयर, क्योंकि वो अगर होगा तो हमारे लोगों को एम्प्लॉयमेंट की बहुत अच्छे अवसर खुलेंगे। नहीं तो अब हम बहुत अच्छा बाइंडिंग है, अभी भी बहुत बाइंडिंग है। तो रोहित सर को भी मैं कुछ ये करता हूं कि वो भी हमें सपोर्ट करें, क्योंकि ISM ग्रेजुएट्स के लिए लीगली बहुत सारे बाइंडिंग्स है। हम नहीं चाहते कि बहुत बड़ा क्लेम करेंगे, लेकिन हमारे एक्सटेंट में, हमारे ट्रेनिंग में, हमारे एक्सपर्टीज में हमको काम करना मिलना चाहिए। नेक्स्ट प्लीज। DNC ये नेक्स्ट प्लीज, नेक्स्ट प्लीज, नेक्स्ट प्लीज, नेक्स्ट प्लीज। हाँ, यहाँ पे एपिडेमिक डिसीज, हमने अभी कोरोना में एपिडेमिक एक्ट का पता हमको कोरोना में चला, अभी कुछ अमेंडमेंट होना उसमें बाकी है। इसमें हमारे बहुत सारे बंधु कोविड के इसमें हमारी जान गंवा सके, उसका कंपेंसेशन नहीं मिला है। अगर इसमें इंक्लूजन अगर करेंगे तो ही आगे जाके वो मिल सकता है। तो मेरे बंधु और भाई को ये कहना है कि हमको लेटर लिखे आप कि हमारा इसमें हमारे ग्रेजुएट्स का भी अंतर्भाव करें। और अभी आप देखे होंगे 2-4 दिन पहले हमारे पार्लियामेंट में इंडियन एविडेंस एक्ट, इंडियन पिनल कोड एंड क्रिमिनल प्रोसीजर एक्ट, ये तीनों ही खत्म होके हमारे तीन अलग एक्ट आए हैं अभी 2023 के। तो ये तीनों भी एक्ट हमारे इसमें लीगल इसमें बहुत काम आते हैं, तो हमारे लोगों ने उसको भी ध्यान से पढ़ना चाहिए। नेक्स्ट प्लीज, नेक्स्ट प्लीज, नेक्स्ट, नेक्स्ट। परमिशंस, बहुत सारे परमिशंस है, आपको सब पता है, NABH, ISO, फायर, बायोमेडिकल वेस्ट वगैरह। नेक्स्ट प्लीज, नेक्स्ट प्लीज, नेक्स्ट प्लीज, नेक्स्ट, नेक्स्ट। एक्रेडिटेशन, नेक्स्ट, नेक्स्ट। हाँ, ये वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग जिसके ऊपर हम अभी काम कर रहे हैं। नेक्स्ट प्लीज। एक है, यहाँ पे गुरुजन है, कुछ विद्यार्थी है, कुछ सीनियर्स है, खपड़े सर है, डीन है। एक मेरी हम्बल रिक्वेस्ट है सबको, बीइंग अ प्रोफेशनल्स, एक केस है यहाँ पे, एक कंप्लेन आई थी कि ऑन पेपर स्टूडेंट बोल के, यहाँ पे नाम वगैरह कुछ नहीं लिखा मैंने जानबूझ के, लेकिन डिस्कस करना चाहता हूँ। ऐसी थी कंप्लेन कि उसके सगे भाई ने उसकी कंप्लेन की कमीशन में आके एफिडेविट दे के, क्या था 45 मिनट के एज के बाद उन्होंने BMS को एडमिशन लिया। एडमिशन लेने के बाद हमको कंप्लेन आने के बाद हम गए, इंटर्नशिप चालू है, प्रैक्टिस कर रहे पंजाब में, एडमिशन है बिहार में। हमने दो टीम कॉन्स्टिट्यूट की, एक पंजाब गई, एक बिहार गई, एक टीम में मैं खुद था। वो प्रैक्टिस वहां पे कर रहे, कॉलेज को विजिट किए, इंटर्नशिप को ज्वाइनिंग नहीं, कुछ नहीं, कुछ नहीं। उसको वहां पे मैनेजमेंट मानने को तैयार नहीं, मेरे ऊपर तकलीफ कर रही थी। वहां से फोटो निकाल के उसका कुर्सी पे बिठा के फोटो निकाला कंसल्टिंग का, और मुझे भेजा, और ये तुम्हारा स्टूडेंट वहां पे प्रैक्टिस कर रहा है। जब जाके अभी उसके ऊपर लीगल केस हुई है, FIR भी किया है। नेक्स्ट प्लीज। सेकंड, एक फेक डिग्री, BMS डिग्री नहीं है, 3 साल गवर्नमेंट में काम किया है, 3 साल तो डीएचओ ने कंप्लेन किया, हमारे पास वो सब डिटेल्स आई, हमने तुरंत उसका डिग्री सर्टिफिकेट कौन से यूनिवर्सिटी के उसको भेजा, रजिस्ट्रेशन सर्टिफिकेट काउंसिल को भेजा वेरीफाई करके, फिर करने के बाद कुछ नहीं मिला, पूरा फेक हो गया, उसको डबल एफआईआर उसके डिस्ट्रिक्ट में भी हो रहा है, हमारे पास से भी हो गया। नेक्स्ट प्लीज, ये वही वो इसकी बातमी थी। नेक्स्ट प्लीज, एक 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 टीचर है, 5 साल से यूजी नहीं है, पीजी नहीं है, कुछ नहीं है, पूरा फेक करके एक स्टेट में काम कर रहे हैं, उसका भी इन्वेस्टिगेशन किया, पूरा वो निकल गया, उसके बाद उसकी हियरिंग की, उसके स्पाउस के साथ हियरिंग की, वो एग्री हो गया, उसका भी लीगल डिपार्टमेंट पे भेजा है। नेक्स्ट प्लीज, ये कंप्लेन थी कि एक कपल, कृपा करके मैं अभी भी बोल रहा हूँ क्योंकि ये बात बोलने में बहुत तकलीफ होती मुझे भी, क्योंकि मेरे फ्रैटर्निटी के लोग हैं, मेरे भाई है, एक कपल है, एक जगह पे दोनों भी असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर बोल के काम कर रहे हैं दूसरे स्टेट में, और बड़ा सा हॉस्पिटल भी खोला है, हॉस्पिटल के साथ रजिस्ट्रेशन बोर्ड में कंप्लेन आई कि दो जगह पे कैसे काम कर सकता है एक आदमी, उधर भी टीचर बोल के और इधर भी प्रैक्टिशनर बोल के, उसके लिए वो काम मेरे पास आया, तो मैंने खुद विजिट किया अलॉन्ग विद द रजिस्ट्रार ऑफ दैट बोर्ड, जो प्रैक्टिसिंग बोर्ड, तो वो दोनों ही उनके चिकित्सा में पा गए 11 बजे, 11 बजे कॉलेज है 70-72 किलोमीटर 62-65 किलोमीटर। तो कृपा करके इनका, ये हमारे ही फ्रैटर्निटी के लोग हैं, तो ऐसा ना हो किसी के ऊपर हमारे एक्शन लेने की नौबत आए, ये हमारे लिए अच्छा नहीं है, तो वो थोड़ा कृपा, हम भी, हमारे कोई दोस्त कोई अगर ऐसा प्रैक्टिस करते होंगे ऐसी पद्धति के, तो थोड़ा सा उसको समझाइए प्लीज़। नेक्स्ट प्लीज़। ऐसे ही ऑन पेपर टीचर की एक तमिलनाडु से कंप्लेन आई थी, हमारा टीम पूरा 5 कॉलेज एट अ टाइम एक ही बार में जाने के बाद वहाँ पे बहुत सारे डिफिशियंसीज मिली हमको, उसका एक्शन अभी चल रहा है। नेक्स्ट प्लीज, ये आपको पता होगा महाराष्ट्र में कैसे फेक मेडिकल सर्टिफिकेट फॉर इंश्योरेंस कंपनी, बहुत दिन से एक स्पेशलिस्ट डॉक्टर ये दे रहे थे। नेक्स्ट प्लीज, ये एनसीआईएसएम ने एक पत्र लिखा है आयुष पद्धति के बीमा का लाभ। नेक्स्ट प्लीज, अभी ही एनएमसी ने एक रेगुलेशन एक्ट किया है कि ये रुग्णांनी गैरवर्तन केल्यास डॉक्टर उपचार नाकारू शकतात, इस तरह का रेगुलेशन अभी पास हुआ है, हमारे प्रैक्टिशनर के लिए अच्छा है ये। नेक्स्ट प्लीज, और रिकॉर्ड, मेडिकल रिकॉर्ड ऑफ प्राइवेट प्रैक्टिशनर अप टू कम से कम 3 साल तक तो हमको मेडिकल रिकॉर्ड रखना है हमारा। नेक्स्ट प्लीज, ये भी फेक इश्यू का मामला है। नेक्स्ट प्लीज। थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर पेशेंस लिखनिंग। थैंक यू। नेक्स्ट।
थैंक यू सर, it was very really informative sessions. We got a detailed insights of ethics and legal aspects. I'm requesting Dr. Veena ma'am to review the session.
Thank you Dr. Rita. Mujhe pata hai ki abhi हम सब का ब्रेन तो नॉलेज से भरा है लेकिन पेट खाली हो रहा है, इसलिए मैं आपका ज़्यादा समय नहीं लूँगी। आई कॉन्ग्रेचुलेट डॉक्टर राहुल सूर्यवंशी सर एंड टीम ATA फॉर ऑर्गेनाइजिंग सच अ वंडरफुल नेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंस। आई एम वेरी मच थैंकफुल टू ऑर्गेनाइजिंग कमिटी फॉर गिविंग मी द चांस एज अ चेयरपर्सन फॉर दिस सेशन। I heartily congratulate Dr. Narayan Jadhav sir for giving us the feast of knowledge. The topic ethical and legal aspects in Ayurveda profession is very genuine. The lecture is very informative. हम सबको पता है कि आयुर्वेद के अच्छे दिन तो है ही, लेकिन आने वाला समय ये आयुर्वेद का है, ये हम सबको पता है। लेकिन जैसे ही हमारा समय आता है तो हमारा बुरा वक्त भी उसी समय साथ साथ में चलता है। जैसे हम काम करते हैं हमारे प्रॉब्लम्स भी बढ़ जाते हैं, तो अभी तो आयुर्वेद का समय आ रहा है, आयुर्वेद का समय आने वाला है, तो हमारे लीगल प्रॉब्लम्स जो है उसका हमें पता होना चाहिए, और सर ने उसकी डिटेल इन्फॉर्मेशन हमें दी है। हम जब BMS पास होते हैं तो हमारे सर्टिफिकेट पे एक MMP एक्ट 1961 लिखा होता है। हमारे में से कितने लोगों को पता है कि ये एक्ट क्या है? अभी सर ने भी इसका यहाँ पे थोड़ा सा ये दिया, इन्फॉर्मेशन दिया, लेकिन पहले हमें ये एक्ट क्या है, जो MMP 1961 एक्ट है, ये पहले पढ़ना चाहिए, क्योंकि हमें अब जब प्रैक्टिस करनी है, एकेडमिक में आना चाहिए, तो हमें हमारे राइट्स का पता होना बहुत ज़रूरी है। तो अभी मेरे पास एक केस आया था, अभी लेटेस्ट एक केस आया था, पूना का ही केस है, मैं डॉक्टर का नाम नहीं बताऊंगी, कि MS आयुर्वेद गायनेक था, एक हस्बैंड और वाइफ थे, उसकी डिलीवरी हो गई थी, बच्चा 1 महीने का बच्चा था, और वो फैमिली में कुछ तो भी प्रॉब्लम हो गया, वो हस्बैंड वो बच्चा लेके चला गया, वो वाइफ उसके मायके में थी, तो वो ब्रेस्ट फीडिंग कर रही थी, तो बच्चा हस्बैंड लेके गया, उनमें कुछ तो भी पुलिस केस हो गया, तो वाइफ तो बच्चे को दूध नहीं पिला सकती थी, उसको फीवर आ गया, वो आयुर्वेद डॉक्टर के पास, MS गायनेक आयुर्वेद डॉक्टर के पास आ गई, ब्रेस्ट कंजेशन हो गया था उसका, डॉक्टर ने उसको मेडिकल सर्टिफिकेट दे दिया जो कि बराबर था, तो वो पुलिस केस हो गया, कोर्ट में गया, तो कोर्ट ने ये बताया कि ये डॉक्टर ने दिया हुआ सर्टिफिकेट ऑथेंटिक है कि नहीं। अभी मेरे पास लेटेस्ट केस आया था कि जब हम डिग्री ले रहे तो हमें हमारे राइट्स भी पता होने चाहिए कि हमें क्या करना है। जब तक हमें पता नहीं है, दूसरों को तो पता नहीं चलता, सोसाइटी को पता नहीं चलता है कि ये डॉक्टर को, अगर ये कोर्ट को पता नहीं है कि इस डॉक्टर को ये सर्टिफिकेट देना बाकायदा ये कायदेशीर है या नहीं है, तो हमें अपने राइट्स के तो पता होना बहुत ज़रूरी है, क्योंकि हमारा समय अभी आ रहा है, तो हमें पूरी तैयारी के साथ उसमें हमारा समय अपने को कंटिन्यू करना है। तो मैं ज़्यादा समय तो नहीं लूँगी अभी। तो सर ने अभी एक बात बताई थी कि वेलनेस में इंडिया का 6th नंबर है, तो कल तो 15 अगस्त हो गया था, उसकी थीम थी कि नेशन फर्स्ट ऑलवेज फर्स्ट, तो आज 16 अगस्त के ये जो एटकॉन कॉन्फ्रेंस है उसमें मैं बताना चाहूँगी कि आयुर्वेद फर्स्ट एंड ऑलवेज फर्स्ट जो अभी हमें लेना है। तो इसी के साथ मैं मेरे 2 शब्द समाप्त करती हूँ, धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू सो मच मैम। फॉर फैलिसिटेशन आई रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर रेवन सिद्ध उस्तुर्गे सर टू प्लीज फैलिसिटेट आवर स्पीकर डॉक्टर नारायण जाधव सर। Dr. Nitin Chandurkar sir to facilitate our chairperson Dr. Veena ma'am. Ma'am, for giving a valuable time. Now this session is over. I'm hand over this stage to Dr. Sonia ma'am.
Thank you so much. Now it's a lunch break for 20 minutes. We'll start our next session at sharp 2:15 p.m. It's kind request to all the dignitaries and guests, please join the sessions on time. Thank you so much.